10 weeks ago, most of you at home would never have heard the name Emma Raducanu. Tonight she plays for history, her name on the front and back pages, trending around the world. A win, and she becomes the first British female singles champion in half a century. What a 10 weeks it's been.
Emma Raducanu is not going to return. She has retired from this fourth round match against Ayla Tomljanovic.
This whole week has just been absolutely incredible. I've never felt support like it. I'm just so, so grateful.
From Great Britain, Emma Raducanu.
Match point number two to the 18-year-old in her second Grand Slam. Raducanu with a huge forehand winner.
Just been remarkable, and for someone so young, way, way too impressive to even describe.
Forehand netted and it's game, set, match. He has been ruthless and aggressive, and now the 18-year-old qualifier is a Grand Slam quarter finalist.
I mean, is there any expectation? I'm a qualifier, so technically on paper, there's no pressure on me.
And Gigi is netted.
Match point for the US Open final for Emma Raducanu. She's underneath the lob and she smashes it away to win.
Crazy, cool. I never thought it would come this early to be in a Grand Slam final.
Welcome to Five Live Tennis, to the final of the US Open women's singles at Flushing Meadows, where in an hour from now, 18-year-old British qualifier Emma Raducanu will walk out on the 24,000 capacity Arthur Ashe Stadium to face 19-year-old Canadian Leylah Fernandez. Ball by ball commentary to come. What an evening we have ahead of us, and I'm very happy to be spending it in the company of Laura Robson, Pat Cash, David Law, and over in New York, tennis correspondent Russell Fuller. And Russ, could you start by telling us how things are looking, feeling and sounding an hour ahead of the players walking out?
There's a feeling of tension, Gigi, at least in my stomach, as I watched Emma Raducanu practice with her left-handed coach, Andrew Richardson. Very handy that, with Leylah Fernandez also being a left-hander, on practice court number one, a couple of courts away from where Daniil Medvedev was beginning his preparations for tomorrow's men's final. Decent crowd watching, warm day, not unbearably hot, some cloud cover, around about 25, 26 Celsius. And the Arthur Ashe Stadium at the moment has very few spectators inside it, but they have already watched British success. A double for Joe Salisbury, who's won the mixed doubles with Desiree Kravchik, to add to the men's doubles title he won with Rajiv Ram yesterday. But they'll be back within an hour for the start of this women's singles final. Unprecedented situation Emma Raducanu finds herself in, literally, because no qualifier has ever gone this far in a Grand Slam before.
Yeah, it certainly is. Now, David, with each round that Emma Raducanu won and progressed, we would try and find examples in other sports that are comparable to this. Now, throughout today, I've heard Leicester City's run to the Premier League title in 2016 come up, and I saw that one bookmaker would have paid out odds of 5,000 to 1 for these two players to make the US Open final, the same odds given to Leicester City at the start of that season.
Yeah, I would say that's accurate. That's how it feels to me, and it has all the way through the tournament. There are other moments in sporting history in Britain, for instance, when Michael Owen scored in the World Cup as a teenager and Wayne Rooney's announced his arrival on the scene and Muhammad Ali winning Olympic gold all those years ago. But this in tennis certainly is without a comparison, really. To come in, as Russell says, as a qualifier, that's never happened. To come in as a novice, really, onto this stage and sweep all before her. I mean, if you consider Serena Williams took 8 Grand Slam tournaments before she reached a final, and I don't think we will ever forget her doing that. That came in 1999 when she played her first.
It's a third championship point for Serena Williams against Martina Hingis. Williams serving at match point. Hingis with a double-fisted backhand, and it's long. And Serena Williams is the US Open champion. She cannot believe it. There's a look of utter disbelief on her face. And the entire Arthur Ashe Stadium court rises to acclaim an American champion.
Now, that was her first of 23 Grand Slam singles titles, and nobody's going to sit here and say that this is the first of 23 for Emma Raducanu or anything like that, but it was her eighth tournament to get to a final. It's the second that Emma Raducanu has ever played, and here she is in the final. It is really quite extraordinary.
And already in the live rankings, she's gone ahead of Serena Williams, and Emma Raducanu's dropped just 27 games and no sets to get to this stage in the main body of the draw. Serena Williams conceded just 32 on her way to the 2014 US Open title. It's mind-blowing, some of these things that we're reading. Pat Cash, it is a pleasure to have you with us in our Strictly Come Dancing ballroom.
Thank you. I thought you guys would be all dressed up and dancing around, or at least doing something. I don't know if I should dance with David. He's a bit too tall for me.
I'd have been keen.
Yeah? Okay, maybe we can do it. Well, maybe we'll do it after she wins the final.
I was going to say, can we do it later? He's lovely, but David, you think about that.
We'll celebrate. We'll have a jig around here.
For celebrations later, there can be a little jigging taking place. But when for these players, there's going to be a lot of jigging, because it's been life-changing for both of them. But what has stood out with Emma Raducanu is just how ruthlessly impressive she has been round after round after round.
Yeah, I haven't had the opportunity to see every match of hers, but the performances have been clinical. I mean, it's ridiculous to think that she hasn't dropped a set on her way through here. And, you know, she's played some very good players. Bencic, I sort of had as one of the favourites of the tournament. And she dealt with her, quite easily. It's quite fascinating. I keep trying to come up with a reason, an answer to why she's going so well. I just keep saying to myself, maybe just one of these things is unexplainable. I mean, to come through qualifying, second tournament, I mean, all these things we've just talked about, it's absolutely unbelievable. I mean, it really is unbelievable. And, she's got she's favourite for this final. We're getting ahead of ourselves. Obviously, it's a whole different ball game now that's in the final, of course, the pressure and everything else. And now, all of a sudden, the first time, she's playing somebody that, I should win this match. And that's a different ball game, but she's dealt with everything so well so far. I can't see it making too much of a difference.
And Laura Robson, what were your parting words when you left us at the end of the at the end of the first week?
Well, I text Russell saying, well, let's hope when I come back next week that Emma is still in the tournament. And it's come true. He replied to me saying, can you imagine? Well, here we are. We're in the final a week later. And I just can't believe the level of tennis that Emma's played at, and, how she's dealt with all the situations that have been thrown under pressure. She's saved so many break points in the last couple of matches. And it's a bit of a combination of her high-ranked opponents being very nervous to play someone so much younger than them, with far less experience, and Emma just enjoying the moment. She looks like she's grown with every match. The confidence, I think, is sky high at the moment. But as Pat said, it's an entirely different matchup tonight against someone who, she probably feels like she should win against.
I can tell you there's a lot of head shaking in New York as well, Laura. I was talking to Tim Hemman just a while ago, and that's his feeling too. Can't quite get his head around what has happened, and neither can Emma Raducanu, as we've been hearing. She felt that she had a level in her game that perhaps could live with some of the better players in the world for a period, but she was saying how, I'm not sure I can sustain it for a set, let alone two, or a whole match, or the next round, or a semi-final. But she's proven to herself she can.
Yeah, she certainly has. One of the tough things from our point of view, or my point of view, has been coming up with new words to describe what she's doing. I'm sort of running out of superlatives, so I just end up saying the same word again and again and again. It's a little bit of a theme for this tournament. So how about Emma Raducanu? What words did she use for this run that she's on?
Surprise, crazy, cool. To be here in New York for 3 weeks is just absolutely mind-blowing for me. I never thought it would come this early to be in a Grand Slam final, but yeah, what can I say? I'm really enjoying my time in New York, and that's showing in my tennis. I love playing on court, being under the lights on Arthur Ashe Stadium. That's so iconic, and I think I was just thriving in the moment.
Do you feel pressure? Because it doesn't look like it to us.
I don't feel any pressure to win. I think any pressure is just self-inflicted and your own expectations of your level. Obviously, I have expectations of my level and how I want to perform, but No, no pressure in terms of results.
And are you aware of the history? Because a lot of British women have been trying to reach a Grand Slam final for these past 44 years since Virginia Wade last managed to do it, and you do it at the second time of asking.
I had no idea of this record. It obviously means a lot to be one of the first in the final for so long, but I think all of the British tennis girls, we're all playing very well right now, and they're a very nice bunch of girls, so yeah, I'm sure that we keep pushing each other up the ranks and progressing.
They are a very nice bunch, and one of that nice bunch who knows Emma Raducanu well, together with Laura Robson, is Naomi Brody. Hello, Naomi.
Hello! I'm back. I'm joining you all from afar. I'm so excited.
Now, I was going to say, how are you feeling? Nervous and excited, or just pure excitement?
Excitement! I can't wait. I'm with Emma. She's got absolutely nothing to lose. We have no reason to be nervous, win or lose today. She has had an amazing week, and I'm just excited. I can't wait for the final to start.
Tell us a little bit about the Emma Raducanu you know or have got to know away from the tennis court, and is she the same as the one that comes across on the tennis court?
I think she's exactly the same. I don't know if Laura would agree, but I think her personality comes across quite a lot, as it does with Leylah as well. For Emma, she's very intelligent. I think we can see that she's very eloquent in the way she speaks afterwards. And just some of the comments that she makes throughout the tournament, when we were saying to her, you know, is it strange that, has the energy gone out the locker room? Is it, you know, is that affecting you in a negative way? Now it's quite empty at the end of the tournament. She's like, no, I can get a practice court easier. Like, she just views things in a different way to how a lot of other people would potentially view them. And even just then in that interview that we just heard, that clip, she just feels no pressure at all. And I believe her. I don't think she's trying to put on a front or anything.
Naomi, since last year when you guys all played the Battle of the Brits and we could all see the level that Emma was playing at, have you felt like her personality has grown since then, since her huge A-level exams and also from so many achievements over the last couple of months? I think she's come out of her shell a bit more over the last few weeks especially.
Yeah, I agree completely. I think Wimbledon was actually a really strong learning experience for her, both with the way that the tournament ended for her, but just in the way that the media attention would be maybe as well. As you say, at Battle of the Brits, I think she was a bit more quiet than she was maybe during the grass season, but maybe that's because I was just spending more time around her as well. But as you say, the level was so clear to me during Battle of the Brits. The mental toughness side of things as well, but she was the contender. She was kind of the one player that if you drew her at any of the tournaments, not just at Battle of the Brits, but at the Pro Series events as well, which she won, she was that one player that if she was in your side of the draw, you'd kind of write it off as a loss almost before you even stepped on the court, because she was just next level. She and Heather had an incredible battle at the Battle of the Brits right before Christmas. I think Heather won that in three sets, but yeah, amazing.
Yeah, I remember just from practicing with her even a couple of years ago how well she was hitting the ball. And you just thought, oh my goodness, her ball strike is something to be reckoned with. But she's just grown so much in her game, and, you know, her strengths have improved, but her weaknesses have improved so much. And I was just wondering if you've managed to speak to her over the last few days and see how she's feeling about this huge, huge match tonight.
Do you know
I'm
what?
Nervous.
Are you nervous?
I've got a huge pit in my stomach. I'm excited, but if I feel this nervous, I can't imagine how Emma's feeling.
I know, but I keep just trying to remind myself that, I'm comparing her to me, but she thinks so differently to the way I approach situations. So I keep thinking to myself, maybe that's not a good thing, though. If I'm excited, then maybe she will be nervous. But yeah, I agree with you completely. I think she's improved an incredible amount. You said it, I think, at the start of the tournament, how much she's improved, even just from when she's been out in the States already. She's just grasped that level of intensity that's needed on the tour already. She beat the player earlier in this tournament. Was it in the second round that she lost to in the first tournament out in the States? She lost to her super easily, and then she absolutely thrashed her this week. Oh, well, how many weeks ago it was now? 2 weeks ago. But no, I'm just really excited. I hope she is as well. The way she's speaking in her interviews, it sounds as if she's got nothing to lose. She said it, you know, instant reaction to Renee Stubbs when she said, are you approaching this differently now you're playing against a fellow teenager? And Emma just said, no, I'm a qualifier. There's absolutely no pressure on me whatsoever. So I hope that she has truly feeling that way. And I hope she enjoys it, because sometimes when you're incredibly nervous, it's almost not an enjoyable experience. So hopefully she feels that, that this is just the first of many Grand Slams, and it's not her only opportunity that she'll face.
And she's very rounded, isn't she? She doesn't have a one-track mind. She's tried her hands at lots of different things growing up, whether it was ballet dancing or tap dancing, but lots of different sports,
as
you'd expect.
Wasn't she good at go-karting or something?
She was. That's probably her biggest passion, Naomi. She started go-karting at the age of 5 and then switched to motocross at the age of 8, which I think is something her dad thought would be good for her to bring her out of her shell a little bit more. And she remains a big F1 fan. She was watching the Dutch Grand Prix, I think it was, last weekend on her day off on Sunday.
Amazing. I saw she got to go down to Silverstone after Wimbledon as well, I think it was. My Formula One knowledge is terrible, but I think that's where she was. Well, it was somewhere with some fast cars.
Brilliant. No, I think you did quite well with that description. Pat, maybe she's got too much going on, but how important is it for players and players you work with to have these other interests and it not just be 100% tennis?
Well, I think it's important. Yeah, absolutely. There's, tennis is part of life, isn't it? And it's for a lot of us, growing up, it is, the main thing, obviously. But you do see players, and I think it's one of the concerns, maybe not so much in this generation or even the previous, but certainly before, even just after mine, is that kids would quit school very early and focus everything on tennis and not continue their studies. Inevitably, the very, very, very few players, come through and make money in tennis. It's a brutally tough sport. So to have something to fall back on, but, you've got to have interest. We see Ash Barty, for instance. She's a classic case where she went and played cricket, and she wants to play Aussie rules football when she retires, she says. She had lots of interest outside of tennis, and that was sport, of course. But, other players have different things. I had my guitar, so there was stuff that I like to do, and I was dragging that around until I had two kids, and that was all the prams and everything. Forget about that. But yeah, she seems very, very balanced, and she's just, I think this is just all a bit of a dream come true, and she's not overthinking it. I think that's the crucial thing. She's just not overthinking it. I think she clearly overthought things at Wimbledon and got herself in a right mess, I'm not sure she have any sports psychology advice off the back of that. Does anybody know about that? But she seems to have done something right.
I think it really helped her that she took a bit of time off after Wimbledon and actually left the country fairly quickly as well, in terms of coming to the tournaments out in the States and just getting away from the attention a bit more. Yes, she enjoyed the Euros final, and I think she even went to the semi-final as well and Silverstone. But there's a real effort, I think, to calm things down after Wimbledon and just to reset. And obviously that's worked, because here we are a couple of weeks later and she's in a Grand Slam final.
Yeah, I agree completely. I think so often she makes decisions that I think she must have a good team around her, because she must be getting good advice to head out to the States so quickly straight away. I think it's just that attitude of, let's go to the next one, let's learn from what's happened, but I'm not going to dwell on it. I don't need to take months and weeks out of the tour. I'm going to get right back on it. Straight back on the horse, isn't it? She just got back going again. And we've said it so many times, it was great. She dropped down and played some ITF level tournaments, which she needed to do because of that was her ranking. I'm not sure she'll ever need to do that again now. But she's had a few in there for the experience. And now the sky's the limit.
Yeah, current ranking 32. Wins a title, she goes to 23. Naomi, it's been a pleasure. Enjoy the final, and maybe we'll catch up with you a little bit later, but definitely tomorrow from midday.
Oh, fab. So I will see you tomorrow, so I can bring you a blue WKD GG. I was worried that I wouldn't get to.
Look, Pat's looking as if, what on earth? Apparently it's this drink that I've never tried.
Pat's definitely had one.
Pat's looking as if he's
just
forgotten. One.
Blue? Anything that's coloured blue can't be good for you, surely.
That's a lack of disgust on his face.
I know you're the guy in that room that's had one. I just already know it.
I think it's like an Alco Pop thing. I don't know. Yeah. But
I've been
told I have to suffer one if Emma
Raducanu
wins.
Flaming Lamborghinis were my thing back in the day. Can you bring one of those in?
Right, can we cancel Naomi coming in tomorrow? Anybody listening? But no, it's been a pleasure, and I look forward to seeing you tomorrow.
Fingers crossed, everyone.
100%. If you'd like to get in touch with us at 5 Live Sport, Matt said, come on, Emma Raducanu. Raducanu, you got this. One of the most impressive runs to a final I've ever seen, and the whole country is behind you cheering loud. Paul, interesting final. Not something I'd normally bother with, but can't wait for tonight. And Jane Hill, you might know Jane Hill from reading the news on TV. If someone has a long-standing arrangement to have dinner with friends tonight, is it rude to ask to put the telly on? See, I don't think it would be rude to just cancel it. I mean, let alone put the telly on. At Five Live Sport, let us know where you're watching, listening tonight, who you're with, and how you're feeling about it all. Now, you've heard us all say at points over the last week that we are lost for words when it comes to what Emma Raducanu is doing. Well, former Wimbledon champion Marion Bartoli feels exactly the same.
I'm on the same page as my colleagues. I mean, I've been discovering Emma at Wimbledon, I think, like everyone else. You know, I thought she would be great, but I didn't thought she would be that soon the amazing champion she's starting to become. And that was really a surprise. And for her to go already from 9 matches, I mean, she had to qualify. She has to go through so many things already just to be in the main draw, which is a tough task, you know, to qualify in a Grand Slam. It's not easy at all. And she went through this and then starting her campaign into the main draw and just literally beating everyone without dropping a set and barely games as well. So this is really incredible. We're witnessing, I think, the born of a true superstar, probably of the next decade of women's tennis. And I mean, she played her first WTA events right after Wimbledon when she got a wild card. And she lost to a Chinese player that actually she played again at the first round of the US Open, second round, and this time she beat her in 2 sets. So also you can see the improvement. It's so quickly from her. She's such a fast learner. But I think, you know, she has something else within herself that just tells her that no matter what is in front of her and how high is the hurdle, she will just pass it. And that is only very few sports people are able to think that way, and she's definitely one of them. And for me, she's really made for history. She's just built for this, and she will go on. And even if she doesn't win this one, she will win one very quickly after that. And I'm so excited actually to see her play for the next decade or so, because I just love her game as well. She moves really well, but she's very aggressive as well. She comes inside the court. She tries to take the ball early. She's eating it off winners. And that's a sort of game style I love to see her play. And it's just so great. It's so exciting as well to see someone that young, to be able to inspire the young generation around the world. I think that is what tennis needs, and especially women's tennis needs.
Marion Bartoli speaking there and speaking a little earlier. And Laura, we've already heard stories of young girls wanting to pick up a racket because they have seen and heard about what Emma Raducanu was doing. That's already inspiring them.
I think so. You know, the last couple of days I've been walking around with my dog doing the usual walk in the morning, and there's a bunch of tennis courts. They've been full. They've been absolutely chock-a-block, you know, in the morning, before work, after work. And there's just been so many kids out and about. And I think she's such a good role model, you know, and just the way that she's handled herself in this tournament, but also at Wimbledon. I think even given the situation in the fourth round, it could have been a bit ugly. And just the way that she handled herself over the next few weeks was fantastic. So I really hope it inspires a whole new generation to pick up a racket. And you've also got another teenager in the final in Fernandez. So hopefully the same thing is happening in Canada. But I think it's a real turning point in the women's game in particular. I'd love to see this type of thing happen in the men's game. We're not quite there yet with the absolute beatdowns that Djokovic is giving everyone. But, you know, I just feel so excited about these two players, what they can bring to the game, not only tonight, but in the future, and how they're going to inspire the juniors coming up to feel like they belong and to give them the confidence to just create all these upsets like we've seen.
I'm particularly enjoying the way she's not allowing people like me and Russell, weary old hacks who've been watching people like Jennifer Capriati come along as teenagers and have difficulties in life and assume it's going to happen to her. Or she just seems to be enjoying the moment and the experience and thinking, well, why wouldn't I go out and win all these tennis matches at the US Open? Because it's great fun. It's just an amazing place to be. And I think that little bubble she's put herself in and determination to enjoy herself, no matter what, has just freed her up, and long may it continue. Good for her.
Maria Sakkari said after the semi-final that Emma Raducanu was fearless. She just went for it. She's not the only one to have pointed out how difficult it can be, even in your mid-20s, when you're facing players like this who feel like they're playing without pressure and have got absolutely nothing to lose. And of course, there's plenty of historical precedent. In recent years, the champions have been a bit older on the WTA Tour at Grand Slam level. Iga Swiatek and Bianca Andreescu were both 19 when they won their recent Grand Slam titles. But the 1990s, Monica Seles, 9 titles as a teenager, Serena Williams, Venus Williams, Martina Hingis, it really was quite normal. And I wonder if we're now edging back towards those days again.
Pat, from your experience working with players and working with younger players, what are the, maybe aside from, you know, you've got the exuberance of youth, but what are the benefits of being a younger player and working with the younger players?
Well, their enthusiasm, obviously, that, you know, they want to get out there and learn. And that's, for me, there is no doubts that one of the number one things for that a champion has is the ability to learn and listen. And there's not one player out there who's not a champion who hasn't been a great learner. And we've talked about how quickly she has learned, Emma. Has learned, and I'm sure her opponents would say the same thing. Look, the enthusiasm. It's what is absolutely astounding is the fact that you know, she's been able to handle, you know, the pressure and continue to play absolutely free. It's a great, and I've talked about this before, but it's a great time in your life when you are in great form. You're young. You're excited every day to get out there and play. And you're playing these matches. You've got nothing to lose. Everybody's nervous to play you, and you can just go out and play your own game. And it doesn't last very long. Certainly from now on in, people are going to start knowing her game, and it may be a little bit. A bit trickier to navigate. I think she probably will, because she's such a great player. But she's got very, very good technique. So, you know, it's for me, it's really important to have very good technique early on, because that sets you up. And you can change things over your career. There's no doubts about that. We've seen players come and fix things, and Rafa continues to fix things, and so does Djokovic. And so that can continue. But she's come in with a very good technique straight away. And that's held her up under pressure. So when you've got funky things in your game and your technique, and then you get nervous, that just goes all over the place. You know, I thought we saw that with Sakkari, where her forehand is a big swing. And when you get nervous, boy, it can go anywhere. Or hit the ball really flat, like Pliskova. When you get nervous, whoosh, the ball can go everywhere. But Emma's got a really nice game, really good top spin and safety when needs be. So she's kind of... you know, we can all be jealous about this, but, you know, in a way, like Roger Federer, he's just natural player that does the right things. And, you know, that's a great, I don't know how, I don't know how they do it, but they seem to have done it.
I think there's been a little bit of strength in numbers as well for this group of young players who suddenly come on the scene out of nowhere. Because in the men's game, there was Carlos Alcaraz, who beat Stefanos Tsitsipas, aged 18. Leylah Fernandez has only just turned 19 this week. She's her opponent, of course, along with Emma Raducanu. And they're not the only ones. I mean, if you look in recent times, Iga Swiatek winning the French Open, of course. We've had Coco Gauff coming along as a 15-year-old, and she's now really starting to move into the upper echelons. And she's in the doubles final alongside Katie McNally, who's 19 years of age. And just listen to this from McNally on what she makes of it all. She said, it's truly incredible, did McNally. I've walked past Leylah and Emma in the locker rooms and have just congratulated them and rooted them on. I think it's unbelievable. Age is just a number. It doesn't mean anything. We're showing that we're fierce and we're ready to be out here competing with everyone. I just think it's awesome. And I like that. I like the idea of them all together thinking, well, she's doing it. Why can't I do it?
And both players as well, David, truly are products of the international world, a globalization, if you like, in that we have Emma Raducanu, who has lived in the UK, in Bromley, since the age of 2. But she was born in Toronto. Her mother, Renee, is Chinese. Her dad, Ian, is from Romania. And Leylah Fernandez has got a dad from Ecuador, Jorge, who also coaches her. We'll hear more from him later, because I tell you what, he's pretty entertaining. And mum, Irene, who was born in Canada, but has Filipino origins, and they both speak more than the one language. Fernandez in particular, I think, is a very, very good linguist. She speaks Spanish, English and French because she was born in Montreal in Quebec, the French-speaking part of Canada. And Emma Raducanu says she speaks a bit of Mandarin, can't write it or read it, tends to speak to her mum in Mandarin so dad can't understand. And I think she's got a little bit of Romanian. Her grandma still lives in Bucharest.
It's a real mix on both sides, isn't it? Thank you for continuing to get in touch with us at 5 Live Sport. If you want to join in the conversation, what your thoughts are on this, where you're going to be listening to it this evening, who you're going to be listening to it with. Kindergarten Klot has said here in Canada, everyone is fully behind Fernandez and incredibly proud. But the press, they're already covering their bases and saying she's playing against Toronto-born Raducanu. Hashtag BBC Tennis. She'd moved from Toronto when she was 2 years of age. It would be easy for us to spend this hour talking about Emma Raducanu, but there's a young lady the other side of the net who only turned 19 on Monday. She brought in cupcakes and delivered them to the locker room to say happy birthday. She's kind of like a baby-faced assassin, isn't she, Russ? She's so young-looking. She's so ruthless. And the advantage on Emma Raducanu is she has that little bit more experience, if only just playing on the main WTA tour.
Yes, we've known about her for a while, haven't we? She won her first WTA match on home soil at the age of 15, just over 3 years ago. She then was the runner-up to Heather Watson in a WTA final in Acapulco last year when she was 17 and won her first title this year in Monterrey. She's also had success at Grand Slam level as a junior, Roland Garros Girls Champion in 2019. She's not actually had a great run since winning that title in Monterrey. The US Open, ironically, was the first time she'd recorded back-to-back wins at main draw level since then. But yeah, she's not exactly battle-hardened, but she may have one or two scars that possibly might stand her in good stead in this final.
Because it isn't just those hurdles that you mentioned on the court that Leylah Fernandez has had to overcome. There's also been, well, it sounds like a fair bit of adversity off it too.
The obvious one is that a lot of people doubted me and in my family and my dreams. They kept saying no, that I'm not gonna be a professional tennis player, that I should stop and just pursue going to school. I remember one teacher, which was actually very funny, at that time wasn't, but now I'm laughing, because she told me to stop playing tennis. You will never make it, and just focus on school. And you know what? I'm just glad that she told me that, because every day I have that phrase in my head saying that I'm gonna keep going, I'm gonna push through, and I'm gonna prove to her that everything that I've dreamed of, I'm going to achieve them. But that's basically just the tip of the iceberg. There's many more things that we had to go through as a family. Another example is that my mom had to go to California for a few years to support my family and I in this tennis world. That few years been definitely hard for me, because I needed a mom. I needed someone to be there for me through the age of 10 to 13. I've barely seen her at that time. So every time I saw her, it was like seeing a stranger, but at the same time, someone so familiar. So I was just very lucky to have my mom here in this tournament cheering for me and having fun with me all this time. But we've gone through so many things together as a family, and I'm just glad that right now everything's going on our side.
The family are all now based together in Florida. At the start of listening to Fernandez, when she was talking about the teacher who said, just give up, just work, we were sort of all open mouth at how can someone say that to someone? And Pat, you were sort of pointing your finger at yourself.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got that one as well from my deputy headmaster who told me exactly that. You know, that you, with your attitude, you won't get anywhere and do anything, and you won't be any good at tennis. I know you love it, but you're not going to be any good at that. So I promptly told him what I thought. I got suspended for 3 days and went and practiced tennis for 3 days. My father went back to the school and said, how dare you say that? And you know, I had a great 3 days of tennis practice, which was great.
Well, there we go.
but she's right. That stuck in my mind for a long, long time. And sometimes you need that motivation. We've seen a lot of different players. I mean, Djokovic does it almost every day, doesn't he? Picks somebody out in the crowd or gets fired up and says, right, I'm going to show you. And Medvedev, of course, a couple of years ago, he was picking on the whole crowd. So, you know, sometimes these motivations, and I know Andy Murray likes to have a good old you know, a motivation up his sleeve about something or other. So, you know, it can push you a long way. It can make you really angry as well. But, you know, well done for her.
And Laura, I think we can see it in her game. She's also talked about winning the US Open. It would almost mean the family can be together. They'd never have to be separated again because they've had to fight so hard to get to this point. And the way she battles and the way she has battled in this tournament, it's almost quite reflective of what she's saying about what she's been through.
Absolutely. I think you can tell with the way that she fights for every single point and that she's been down so many times in this tournament and has come back, has just grinded her way through the matches by outrunning people. She outran Kerber in three sets, which not many people with so many more years of experience can do, and then backed it up again and again and again, where she's won these huge three-setters against the top players, has had, I think, by far a tougher draw going into the final. But it's whether that's going to have taken a lot out of her. I think it's a lot of pressure to put on yourself as well, to think, oh, if I win today, I can keep my family together. And I hope it's not too much for her going into tonight, because I want to see both players play as well as they have been, and that we see them both at their best, and hopefully not overcome with nerves. But Fernandez is just, you know, for me, the match of the tournament on the women's side was the one against Kerber, because she just battled, and after every point that she won, she got the crowd involved. She, you know, she's got this arm up in the air after almost every point, and just looks like she engages with them so much more than Raducanu, which I think could maybe come into play a bit tonight. But you know, she's a battler, and I think even if she is nervous, we're just going to see her try and work through that. And she's got the sort of game that's really tricky. She's the lefty, and she just runs and runs and runs. So I can't decide. I'm going back and forth.
Well, you've got a little bit more time before I'm actually going to pin you down on a prediction. But Pat, if you've got adversity off the court, and she actually said that example about the teacher is one of many she could give at people saying, you're no good, you're not going to do this. It can work both ways. You have to, as a player, channel it, because it can overcome you and go completely the wrong way, or as she's done to this point, it can put you on this marvelous run.
Yeah, I mean, the good thing, I suppose, is she was young, so she, you know, she can get through that, and you know, somebody say, oh, don't worry, those teachers don't understand, and which is absolutely true. But yeah, if you, when there's things playing on your mind, you cannot play good tennis. So these two girls are obviously playing, you know, carefree and really enjoying their tennis. But I would say most of what the management does and the coaches do and the other people around it is to protect you, to make life easier as a player. And, you know, that's what I do as a coach. You know, I'm running around. Coaches do all sorts of crazy stuff. You know, they run up the road, they do this, they do that. And I coach a Chinese player. I've never had so much Chinese food in my life. I don't necessarily like spicy food, but that was every day. It was a spicy meal. I actually got to enjoy it. But, you know, you just do these things, and it's to keep, you know, to keep things calm. Not that, you know, Chinese food is bad or anything, you know, that, but you get my point. So they can just relax and focus and watch TV and do whatever they want to do, and they don't have to be concerned. And that's what sometimes is not great. I always quite involved in my business part of me, but when I was coaching Mark Pilipousis, he just said, just do everything. I'm like, what do you mean everything? Just do everything. Do my grips, book my flights, book my hotel rooms, book the practice courts, just do everything. I don't care. And I was like, okay, we'll do it. No problems. And other players are more involved, but, you know, it's because, you know, if you've got dramas with your parents, you know, there's just a friend or a parent or something can just say something when you're tense, and it can just wind you up. I mean, I've lost plenty of matches when somebody said, usually my ex-wife, but you know, said something on the, just as I'm about to walk on the court or during the day, and I've just had a horrible match. So, you know, that's mainly the managers and the coaches' jobs to keep them nice and relaxed. So that's a great effort if she's had all these things in her back of her mind. And Laura might be right. Maybe this is just, you know, maybe it'll be too much for her in the end after all these tough matches.
And
who knows?
Actually, on the subject of Emma Raducanu at Wimbledon, she's sort of learning on the fly, really, how to handle everything that goes on at these tournaments, because it's the only second one she's ever had. You think of what happened at Wimbledon, where it became too much in the moment, and she was pushed physically, and she had some breathing difficulties and withdrew from that match. But since then, she's just settled down and worked out with her small team what works for me, and gradually just got used to it in the space of 6 weeks, and she already comes across as somebody way more comfortable in her own skin and comfortable with what's coming up.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think the fact that she's got a small team with her in New York, unfortunately her parents aren't able to be there because the US was so strict with allowing people in for COVID. But in a way, it's probably helped her that she's been with the same people now day in, day out for, I want to say, 4 weeks, because her agent flew out there early to help her in the lead up to the slam as well, just wanting to get everything organized and keep her mind just on the tennis. But they've had a really good routine going. They've had frozen yogurt every night. They've having the same smoked salmon bagel for breakfast every morning. And they've just got into this nice rhythm where you just feel like she's going out onto the court and just enjoying herself and focusing on the tennis, which is in some ways so easy to do as a young player, but really, really hard to put into place because you've got all these other things going on in your life and, you know, you want to go home, see your friends and everything like that. But I just think she's in a really, really good headspace at the moment.
As someone who's
I very rudely barge in?
Of course.
Because we've got a very special guest in our commentary box, Gigi. Chanda Rubin, very much a friend of Five Live Tennis, who has joined us here. Very, very busy, commentating left, right and centre. Going to do the women's final very, very shortly. Chanda, thanks for dropping by. We've just been talking about Leylah Fernandez's background, the fact she's been on tour for a while, the fact that she feels like maybe she's got a point to prove to a teacher who said she'd never make it as a professional tennis player. What do you think makes her tick?
Well, she's definitely Leylah Annie Fernandez, as she likes to be called. She definitely is playing with a bit of a chip on her shoulder because she was told she would make it, that she should choose another career. And you know, any tennis player, when you tell us left, we're going to go right. And she has rebelled against that in the biggest ways. But this U.S. Open final that she's about to play in, unbelievable, incredible moment. Did not expect her to be at this stage so quickly in her young career, but she has proved a lot more people wrong, and it has been fun to watch.
It's the players she's beaten and the style in which she's beaten them, isn't it? Naomi Osaka, defending champion, Angelique Kerber from a set and 4-2 down, a couple of other top five players in Elina Svitolina and Arina Sabalenka on the Arthur Ashe Stadium under the lights, normally in three sets. Doesn't make sense. How she managed to do it?
You know, if I could bottle that and explain it, I definitely would make a lot of money. I mean, certainly, you know, we can look at what her game entails, and it is an incredible level of competitiveness. She has a level of intensity that she brings literally to every point. We see the fist pump. We see her using the crowd, which so many players have been happy to have this year again, to have that atmosphere. But she has taken it to the max. And on top of it, she's got a tricky game. Doesn't have a huge serve, but she's got a big service game. She's been able to hold serve consistently over these 2 weeks. She comes up with clutch serves under pressure. She's got a tricky lefty forehand, which she can slap at an angle, but she can also hit it up the line. And she does not give up ground, Leylah Annie Fernandez. She doesn't give up ground on the baseline. She stays in there, even against the biggest hitters. She did that in her last match against Arena Sabalenka. It has continued to impress.
Chanda, it's so nice to hear you. I'm sad we can't all be together, but to have you with us. So that is Leylah Fernandez. Let's look at Emma Raducanu. Firstly, what have you and your colleagues been saying about this almost flawless run from Raducanu, and how does her game style match up to that of Fernandez?
Well, you said it so well, Gigi, flawless. And you keep expecting her naturally to, you know, have a couple of doubts in some big moments, to maybe just come up a little bit short. And she just hasn't. And it's not just that Emma Raducanu has been winning matches, but she has been beating people quite badly. Still hasn't lost a set in 9 matches now, because she had to play through qualifying. That is another unbelievable part of, you know, her story. She had to play 3 matches just to get into the main draw. How could you possibly think you could then be a champion at the end of 2 weeks when you couldn't even make it into the draw just yet in her young career? But she knew she deserved to be here. She's played like it. She's got an incredible game. Her serve, bit bigger than Fernandez's. She has hit some excellent serves under pressure moments. And the way she moves the ball from the baseline, where she can hit cross court, but she can change it up and hit up the line with so much confidence. That is not easy to do in these big moments. And she also holds the baseline, hugs the baseline, takes a little bit of time away from opponents. So this is going to be a very interesting clash. I would have to give Emma Raducanu the slight edge, though, in this overall matchup, but I wouldn't want to live on the difference going into this match.
Oh, Chando, we know you've got to get ready for the final. So, Chandaru, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure, and enjoy the final.
Thank you. I will. Looking forward to it.
I think we're all going to love this final. We're going to talk a little bit more about tactics in this matchup. We were talking about superstitions and players being superstitious. Somebody who's very superstitious is Leylah Fernandez's dad, Jorge. Now, he's in Florida. He's not coming because the last time he turned up at a tournament, sort of when it was underway, it was the final at Acapulco. She lost, never forgave himself. And his routine through this US Open run has been same shampoo on the day of the match, same jeans, same socks, and he has to put on the same underwear on match day. So it's all going back on every day.
That's a big commitment.
It's a big commitment.
Sounds disgusting. But he's washing that, right?
Well, he doesn't wash it. I mean, if you had something lucky, you don't wash it. It's like you grow a beard, you grow your beard. You wear the same socks.
Some players are weird. Some like to wash the same outfit. Others go the other way and take a fresh one out of the bag for every match.
Well, but his exact words were same underwear. Same socks, same jeans.
I think he really needs to specify whether he's washed them or not.
Maybe afterwards.
To his friends, probably, who were sitting next to him today on the couch.
And we might have a marriage proposal by the end of this evening, depending on the winner, because Craig's got in touch at Five Live Sport. I told my boyfriend after Wimbledon that if Raducanu ever wins a Grand Slam, I'll propose to him. I'm not sure Craig thought it was going to come around this quickly, but it might turn out to be an expensive night for Craig, should Emma Raducanu go on to win the US Open. Players are going to be out in around, I'd say about 15 minutes from now. Emma Raducanu against Leylah Fernandez. This phenomenal final that we have at Flushing Meadows, and I can see on the Arthur Ashe Stadium. The sun is still shining, the roof is open, and more spectators are taking their seats. Cannot wait for this. You're going to have every ball here on Five Live. Now, you might say to me, Pat, this doesn't matter. They are young, they've got energy to burn. But Leylah Fernandez has spent nearly 5 hours more on court than Emma Raducanu. Will that, should it, play a part when you throw in nerves and the final?
It could, yeah. I mean, well, could. I think it will all unfold. But there's a couple of things that I think will be answered today, obviously tonight. But one is the fact that Fernandez has played so much under big pressure. I mean, she's played the big matches,
fans welcome
big players,
once again to
and
Arthur
you know she's managed to deal with them. And there've been some incredibly tight situations. I mean, one after the other, after the other, after the other. Now, the flip side is Emma hasn't had any pressure at all. She's going to play maybe a first tiebreaker in the whole 2.5 weeks that's coming up. What's going to happen? I mean, she's been playing great and relaxed, and she might just go for it. But we don't know. And you know, it's Laura said it really well. She said she kept saving break points by big serves and big great shots, great points. That's what wins championships: is playing good under pressure, saving break points under pressure situations when it really, really matters, and the crowd is going nuts. Has Emma had that? I'd say no, not at all. But she has been saving the break. But she hasn't even got to the situation. So that's the flip side. She might not even get to that situation if she's playing so well. So it'll be really interesting. It's very hard. Those matches, yeah, they may take the sting out of Fernandez. We'll just have to wait and see. I mean, the semi-final was another brutal one. But I think, it is three sets. We're not talking about, Djokovic playing the five set yesterday and backing it up. So I think she's got enough fitness in there, for sure. But, it's going to be all nerves, isn't it? It's going to be who deals with the situation the best, and that's what the finals are all about.
And that's why it's so interesting, because we don't know what they are like.
We don't know.
On this stage.
We just don't know.
They don't know. They haven't got a clue. And because Raducanu has just been sweeping all before her, it will be. I know maybe there's a lot of people listening thinking, well, I'm quite happy for Raducanu to go and win like that again. But won't it be interesting if she does get dragged down into the trenches where Fernandez has been operating for the last 2 weeks? And we have to see how Raducanu copes with that. It's just one of those things, because there have been a lot of players playing well against Leylah Fernandez over the last 2 weeks and not winning because she has stayed with them. If she stays with Raducanu tonight, It'll be very, very fascinating.
At Five Live Sport to get in touch with us. Jim, listening from a tent in the Peak District in the middle of nowhere. Not enough signal to stream, so relying on you guys. Much better choice there, Jim. Andrea and Jonathan, we're listening from our camper van called Bess. Hello, Bess. On holiday in North Yorkshire. Come on, Emma. So get in touch. We would love to hear where you are going to be listening from. Now, former British number one Tim Henman, who we've seen an awful lot courtside out there, he's been speaking to us, this was a short while ago, and described when he first came across Emma Raducanu.
I haven't seen her play a massive amount over the last sort of 4 or 5 years, but you definitely hear the name you know, obviously with Andrew Richardson, who's coaching her now, he was best man at my wedding. We played against each other from when we were 11. So, you know, I've heard what he's had to say over the years and, you know, with Mark Petchie, Nigel Sears, and just our sort of tennis community in the UK. She's definitely been on the radar, but I'm not quite so sure. I thought she would burst onto the scene quite this quickly in this fashion.
So what can you tell us about Andrew Richardson? Because he is deliberately, for very understandable reasons, flying very much under the radar this fortnight.
Yes, he is, and that is his personality. You know, I think he's very keen for it to be about Emma, and so he's very happy to, you know, be in the background, in the shadows, getting on with his job. He was a decent player. He made third round at Wimbledon, I travelled a lot with him. In the satellites and challenger days, knows the game well, and you know, I think Bartoli knows Emma very well. They've got a great relationship. This is, you know, it's only 6 weeks into them traveling together, and you've got to say it's working quite well. Bye.
And finally, what's your instinct? Do you think she's handled the quarterfinal and the semi-final amazingly well on the Arthur Ashe Stadium? Can she handle the final as well?
I think so. Each match, she's played 3 matches now on Ashe, and they've been a step up every time. And there's no doubt been this a final, her first final, a major final. The intensity is going to be greater, but that's one of her biggest attributes is, her mentality, the way that she focuses, she believes on in herself. And I think she's going to get it done today.
Tim Herman working for Amazon Prime at Flushing Meadows in conversation with Russ a short while ago. I guess one of the things we will look to do off that is to bottle this interest, capture it, get this love of tennis. So many people, and Laura and I, we were talking about this, people that don't really talk or like tennis are getting in touch with us. When's it on and what's happening? And you mentioned, I don't know if he already is, but your boyfriend, what's he doing this evening?
Yeah, he played a football game earlier and the whole team has gone to the pub to watch the tennis, and I am very proud. he watches a lot of tennis because of me, but I think they all would have watched it anyway. All of his friend group is talking about, when's the women's final on? We want to support Emma. And I just think it's captured the nation in a way that we've not seen in such a long time, and how fun that is to have this sort of football energy all crowding around a TV watching the tennis.
I also think it's fantastic for British tennis because when Andy was coming through, there was the system set up in British tennis that was, they call it a trickle down theory, where Andy would really raise everything and create all these players coming in. And they didn't really have a grassroots program in probably the LTA. They've since flipped that idea. So now you're going to see a lot more kids who are going to be motivated by Emma's performances and are actually going to be going into those grassroots, and it's going to be available for them to play tennis, where before it wasn't there. It simply wasn't there. That was what Roger Draper decided to do. He said, I remember going in and having a conversation with him about this, and I said, and I was shaking my head walking out of the meeting. He said, this is not going to work. It hasn't worked anywhere in the world. And they did switch it after about 5 or 6 years, and they started growing the grassroots. So now there's an opportunity for these kids, these young kids who see Emma. She's got everything going for her. She's pretty, she's athletic, she's successful, she's smart. What a role model for us, for British tennis this is. She, more than Andy Murray, is going to bring through player after player after player.
Leylah Fernandez on the screens in front of us is Gus going through her warm-ups backstage with her very excitable fitness trainer. I think that's the best way of describing him. He's up and down every shot. They're quite calm. There's the odd word exchange between them every now and then, because in a few minutes' time, Leylah Fernandez and Emma Raducanu will be introduced out onto the Arthur Ashe Stadium ahead of the US Open final. It is quite extraordinary what they have achieved up to this point. And I think, David, carrying on from what Pat was saying with Emma Raducanu and trying to bottle it and build on it, is, I think, as we now see Emma Raducanu going through some pre-match stretches in the gym, is that she's talked a lot about her schooling. You can have it all. You don't just have to be a tennis player. Go to school. She said how important that was and that balance. So young girls and boys listening think, right, I can still do the education. I can balance it. Not everyone can, but alongside the tennis, and have both.
Yeah, and her parents were insistent that she do that, particularly during lockdown, that she didn't go trying to take risks and travelling all over the place, that she got those A-levels in and she just was ready when things opened up to start being a tennis player. I think that's a much healthier way of being than some of the horror stories we heard of 14-year-olds playing and having enormous success, loads of money, and then really struggling to deal with it all. That's a very different situation to what we have with Emma Raducanu, who is, I agree with Pat, an amazing role model. She's just incredibly likeable, and I think a lot of people are going to be able to relate to her and around the country, quite honestly, and want to follow in her footsteps or want to be like her. And it's a very exciting time in that respect.
Maybe understandably so, but a very serious look on Leylah Fernandez, but then she just breaks into that big grin of hers in conversation with the fitness trainer. Just the two of them in this backstage area. Emma Raducanu surrounded by her team, the jacket on, the tennis gear there, the yellow visor, just taking a drink and just gathering her thoughts, because in minutes from now they'll be walking out for the US Open final. You're going to have every ball here on 5 Live, so stay with us through the evening. What is a truly remarkable event that's about to get underway. But before it does, with the time, it's just coming up to 9 o'clock. Here for you, the news on 5 Live with Dan Maudsley.
Listen on BBC Sounds. This is BBC Radio 5 Live.
Ceremonies have been taking place in the US to remember the 9/11 attacks that killed nearly 3,000 people 20 years ago today. President Biden made visits to each of the sites where hijacked planes crashed in 2001, including the Pentagon near Washington, D.C., where General Mark A. Milley, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, gave an address.
Those who perished here were among the 2,977 killed on that day here in New York and in Pennsylvania. The people we lost that day are not just names and numbers. We remember them today for not only who they were, but for what they could have become.
Well, there have also been remembrance events in the UK, including a private service at Grosvenor Square in London for the 67 British victims of the attacks. Boris Johnson is expected to announce a COVID winter plan for England early next week. Government sources have said further lockdowns are not being considered. The latest daily figures show a further 156 people in the UK have died within 4 weeks of a positive COVID test. 29,500 new coronavirus cases have been confirmed. And 6 people have been arrested off the coast of Plymouth after the authorities seized more than 2 tonnes of cocaine. Among those being held is a British man from Stockton-on-Tees.
More live Premier League football than anyone else.
This
is 5 Live.
Oh!
Sunday, with a 4:30 kickoff, we'll be at Elland Road as Leeds United host Liverpool.
More live Premier League football than anyone else.
Over 140 live subscription-free games.
This is 5 Live.
US Open Tennis with Gigi Salmon on 5 Live.
The women's US Open final, it's the final Grand Slam of the year. We've got the world number 150, the qualifier, Emma Raducanu, very shortly will be introduced out onto court against the world number 73, Leylah Fernandez. But it is straight to Flushing Meadows, to Russell Fuller, where Russ, events taking place on the Arthur Ashe Stadium ahead of the players' introduction are just getting underway. At West
Point. Yes, this is the US Tennis Association and the US Open, and everybody inside the Arthur Ashe Stadium and around the United States and around the world, I'm sure as well, remembering all those affected by the attacks in New York, Pennsylvania and Washington on 9/11, 20 years ago today. We will see a giant American flag rolled out over the Arthur Ashe Stadium court in just a moment. And this is the two-time Tony Award nominee, Daphne Rubin Vega, who's going to sing after a minute's silence.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright
is always marked in such moving style here at Flushing Meadows.
The United States Marine Corps, 6th Communication Battalion, Brooklyn, New York. The all-female cadets from the United States Military Academy at West Point. And Daphne Rubin Vega,
who was singing on a red carpet with a string quartet behind her. The giant Stars and Stripes has been unfurled. It covers virtually the entire width and length of the Arthur Ashe Stadium court and is now being refurled by the military, who will march off the court and leave the stage clear to our two finalists, Emma Raducanu and Leylah Fernandez, who are going to be walking out in just a couple of moments. We're going to have the on-court interview shortly. I suspect they are still 90 seconds away at least. Goodness only knows, Gigi, what those two young women are thinking right now as they wait to be called out onto court for the start of this final. I bet it can't start quickly enough.
Well, Russ, when we saw them warming up, Pat, you were just saying just how weird to see the empty training areas and the empty gym, and just referencing that they did look nervous, and rightly so. This is a Grand Slam final.
Yeah, of course they are. I hope they're nervous. But yeah, it's really strange. Laura and I were just talking about it. It's very strange because these players have been playing, you know, qualifying and first rounds, and you know, we know Fernandez hasn't really got through more than a couple of rounds in tournaments for a long time. So, you know, when you come to the end of a tournament, it's virtually completely empty. The locker room's completely empty. There's obviously locker room attendants running around and doing things like that. But you're up there on your own. And I was thinking Andrew is a really nice, good person to have there, because he's so, I mean, I haven't really caught up with him in recent years, but I used to practice with him quite a bit, and he was always very quiet and very relaxed and easygoing sort of guy. And that's the sort of guy you really want to have in your corner at that time when there's, it's really eerily silent, and all you've got your own thoughts with you. And sometimes, as I said, sometimes it's good and sometimes it's not.
Yeah, and Fernandez as well, I think, was sort of in a zone where she was looking a bit nervous and walked off, and her physio followed her basically, and tried to make her laugh, trying to loosen her up a little bit. And, you know, both players, I think it's obviously very natural to feel nervous in this situation, and it's just who's going to handle it better tonight. But I just hope that they're able to get that out of the way in the first few games and loosen up, enjoy the moment, enjoy what a fantastic experience it is to play in a Grand Slam final. And hopefully they've got many, many more ahead of them. But yeah, this is just huge.
Do you remember Ash Barty at the French Open? Remember the cameras that were in there before the French Open, when they're all playing cricket inside? That's a way to relax.
She looks very relaxed, right? We can see the players in the corridor. They're shortly be called forward for their interviews. If you're going to listen to a pre-match tennis interview for the first time, please don't expect anything much. They are the most random things in the sport, but Russell Fuller, they're about to happen.
Well, if you're ever going to listen to one, Gigi, this is the one to listen to. Emma Raducanu, lost in her thoughts, leaning against the wall at the moment in her red top, her yellow visor. You may hear a countdown in the background in a moment. She's going to be the first one who's called forward to the microphone. Leylah Fernandez, with her hands on her hips, wearing a mask, just standing three or four paces behind her, also waiting patiently for the start of the biggest tennis match of their lives, the biggest occasion of the lives of these two very young women. Raducanu at 18, Fernandez, who only turned 19 on Monday, a couple of months between them. The TV director counting us down. This is what they're hearing. This is what you're hearing live on 5 Live tonight.
Emma, when you arrived here 3 weeks ago to play in the qualifying, what gave you the belief that you could be here today playing in a US Open final?
I think I just believe in myself in general, and the time has flown here in New York. Just been taking it one match at a time, and it's got me to the final. So going to go out there and enjoy it today.
You're playing in your second major. How would you describe this opportunity?
Yeah, I mean, it's so exciting to be in my second Grand Slam and in the final. I can't really believe it, but yeah, I'm going out there today, and I can't wait to just get stuck in. I'm sure the crowd will be great, so it'll be a really positive experience.
Have fun out there. Good luck.
Thank you.
And now let's bring in Leylah Fernandez, who's had an amazing run to the final. Leylah, you have beaten three top five players to reach this round. Describe what these last 2 weeks have been for you.
It's been incredible. I've been having a lot of fun on court. I've been playing well, and I can't wait for our finals today.
You just turned 19. Mm-hmm. Emma's 18. There is no edge in experience going into this major final. What's the greatest challenge you'll face today?
Honestly, I don't know. I think we're just going to go out there, have fun. We've both been playing incredibly well, so it's going to be a good match, and we'll see how it goes.
Best of luck.
Thank you.
Mary Jo Fernandez with the questions.
Please welcome the 2021 U.S. Open finalists. From Great Britain, Emma Raducanu.
She is the youngest woman to compete in a Grand Slam singles final since Maria Sharapova at Wimbledon in 2004. Here comes Emma Raducanu, that trademark smile on her face, one or two union flags waving.
And from Canada, Leylah Fernandez.
Who is the second youngest player to appear in a Grand Slam final since Maria Sharapova at Wimbledon in 2004. And early indications that she will have the bulk of the support. Big cheer for her inside the stadium as she appeared on the big screen to do that interview with Mary Jo Fernandez. She is Canadian after all, and her matches this past 2 weeks have been simply spectacular, beating the defending champion Naomi Osaka, plus Angelique Kerber, Alina Svitolina and Aryna Sabalenka. I think the New York public know her better at this point, but of course the next couple of hours could significantly change that, Gigi.
I think that's exactly right, Russ, and Laura, we've seen that through her matches. She really gets pumped up. She brings them in. She uses the energy. She feeds off the energy of the crowd.
She does, and Fernandez definitely uses the crowd a bit more than Emma Raducanu. Just almost too much sometimes. I feel like she gets so hyped with them, and then it just wastes a lot of energy. But, you know, she's just loved it, and I think in the situations where it's been really tight is when she's used it, the crowd best, and that's when she's kind of looking at certain people in the first few rows, lifting both hands in the air when she wins a big point. And, you know, it's definitely more of a cheer for the Canadian there when they came out on court. And I think already she's loving it. She's smiling a bit more than Emma, I would say. I don't think you can read into that at all. I mean, I'm just so excited and nervous and pumped for this match.
Emma Raducanu is currently standing next to Billie Jean King, which is probably not something that she thought she'd be doing on the Arthur Ashe Stadium on the 11th of September 2021. Billie Jean King, one of the six women of the original nine that signed the $1 contract to bring about the formation of the WTA Tour. They did that in 1970. Would have been the 50th anniversary here last year, but no fans were allowed, so they've had the celebrations 12 months later. The players, those great legends of the game, waving to the crowd. And Leylah Fernandez and Emma Raducanu just wondering if there's another couple of photographs they have to take. They're being conducted by our chair umpire for this final, Marijana Veljevic of Serbia. Now, finally, we can hear the coin toss, if you can hear it in the din.
Well, no, I don't think Emma Raducanu can, Rush. She was leaning forward saying, what did you say? I mean, there's 10 people on the centre of that court. I've never seen so many people in the middle of the court. But now at least the players, I think she's been given the choice, Leylah Fernandez, because Emma Raducanu can't hear her. She's going to serve?
Yes, Leylah Fernandez lost the toss and Emma Raducanu chose to serve, I believe, is the conclusion of the lip-reading jury.
Yeah, I think that, well, you can see my face was repressed up against the screen. So the clock is going to start ticking down on the four-minute warm-up and then we're going to get underway. So we are edging ever closer to this US Open Women's Final. Pat, can I just ask you, we've only got about a minute or so, then we're really going to get stuck into this. If you could have had a final word as a coach with one of those, what would have been your final words before they stepped out for this Grand Slam final?
Well, I think it's pretty simple. You're reasonably patient early on, but if the short ball is there, you've got to go for it. I think unforced errors are going to be very crucial, but you can't just be pushing the ball back. And I think certainly Emma's done that exceptionally well in this tournament. She's just gone for the shots when they're there. But it'd be interesting tactically because both of these girls really love the wide ball. They can produce really amazing angles. Straight up and down the middle is certainly Emma's not as accurate pulling the ball from the middle of the court. So that'll be interesting. Very interesting to see the tactics. But you can't just change your tactics. You know, you've got to play the way that you normally play. So I think there's going to be a lot of running and a lot of wide angle balls, and it's going to be pretty exciting. But, the beginning, there's probably going to be a little bit stuff up and down the middle.
Cannot wait for this. This is Emma Raducanu against Leylah Fernandez to be crowned US Open champion. This is fairy tale stuff in New York, and you're going to hear every ball live right here on 5 Live. Keep getting in touch at 5 Live Sport. You can follow it on the live tech service in the company of Laura Robson, Pat Cash, and our correspondent, Russell Fuller.
This is it, everybody. From qualifying round one through two, through three to the main draw, where the field has been reduced from 128 to 64 to 32 to 16 to 8 to 4 and finally to 2. Leylah Fernandez and Britain's Emma Raducanu. She's just 18 years of age. She's contesting only her second Grand Slam. Can she really tonight, here on 5 Live, become the US Open champion?
Please welcome the players for tonight's final. From Great Britain, Emma Raducanu.
Being under the lights on Arthur Ashe Stadium, that's so iconic, and I think I was just thriving in the moment.
The crowd in darkness, the court lit up, Emma Raducanu in the spotlight.
I wasn't expecting anything, to be honest.
But now the 18-year-old qualifier is a Grand Slam quarter finalist.
To be here is just insane.
Raducanu with a huge forehand winner. Arms aloft.
And it's game, set, match for Emma Raducanu. She has made the US Open semi-finals.
I think I was about 26 when I got to that level, so she's way ahead of me.
She smashes it away to win. And Emma Raducanu stands with her hands on her head laughing because she's made it into the final of the US Open.
And listen to that roar of appreciation for what they've seen.
My name is Leylah Annie Fernandez.
The 19-year-old world number 73 is a Grand Slam finalist.
We go back a long way. She's a nice girl and we've both come so far since we last played each other. There'll be a great atmosphere and support for both of us.
Well, I don't know about you, Laura Robson, but I feel just as I did in July 2013 on centre court at Wimbledon when Andy Murray was trying to become the first British man to win the Wimbledon singles title for 77 years. It was a feeling of excitement, anticipation. There was a little bit of apprehension as well. And here we are, 8 years on, with Emma Raducanu trying to be the first British woman to win a Grand Slam for 44 years. Does it feel similar to you?
It really does. And, you know, I go back to when I spoke to other players at the beginning of the tournament, especially other British players, and there was so much chat of, yeah, I think Emma's going to win a slam one day. None of us thought it'd be this one because she's just blown through the draw in a way that no one could expect. And I have the same feeling. I'm nervous. I'm excited. There's that bit of dread as well because I really hope it's a good match and I hope that both players aren't too nervous, but I think the way that they've come out in the warm-up is already really promising, and you know that they're going for their ball strikes and trying to loosen up the arm a bit as they go. I just think it's impossible to call at the moment. And then, you know, we just saw on the screen the list of players that Fernandez has beaten already in the last week, especially from Osaka on, has been phenomenal. So I just hope it's a good one. I'm feeling hopeful for Emma. I think if you compare the strokes side by side, she's got a bit more to her game, a bit more power from the back of the court, and also moves great, so I don't think it's going to be pushed that wide by Fernandez. But you know, it all goes out the window, doesn't it, in a Grand Slam final.
And we're less than 30 seconds away from the start now on Five Live. Here comes Leylah Fernandez, the left-hander, the 19-year-old, the world number 73, now living in Florida, having been born and raised in Canada. And here comes Emma Raducanu, the qualifier, 150 in the world, still 18 years of age. She's won three matches in qualifying and six in the main draw without dropping a set. Emma, the first qualifier ever to reach a Grand Slam final. Everything else is a bonus. Will this adventure end in a US Open title? She will serve first. And the first serve is a good one to the backhand of Leylah Fernandez. The forehand pushed down the line by Raducanu. Good depth on the reply here by Fernandez, who's now going cross-court with the winner. Excellent start from the Canadian.
I do think it's interesting that Emma's chosen to serve first. I think a lot of players prefer to return first just to get that first game out of the way, you know, hit a few live balls and try and rip a few just to loosen the arm, loosen the legs. You don't want that early break.
Love 15 down, another first serve landed by Raducanu. Down the line she goes with a forehand. Fernandez with a forehand down the centre. Fernandez cross court and into the net, trying to repeat the trick of the first point of the match. But the first couple of points have been shared, and it's good to see that both players are on the board.
And already a little fist bump from Emma Raducanu. Just a small one, but just showing her opponent she's in this.
15 all. Around about 20,000 people, I would say, in the Arthur Ashe Stadium at the moment. So that is a greater capacity, even though it's not quite full here, than Centre Court at Wimbledon. The biggest crowd you get anywhere in tennis. Raducanu misses the first serve for the first time, but the second one is good. The forehand cross-court by Raducanu onto Fernandez's backhand. Cross-court goes Raducanu, good defence from Fernandez. Forehand down the line, Raducanu. Fernandez reaching for it, defending hard. Another big forehand from Raducanu. Fernandez gets another ball back, but it's a short put away for Raducanu. Hitting very powerfully from the word go, and eventually she broke down Fernandez's defences.
Great forehand down the line there, wrong-footed Fernandez. And that set that opened up the court. Fernandez was looking for the cross-court forehand. That's certainly been one of Raducanu's strengths this tournament. Down able to go straight down the line. It's the shorter way home.
30-15, another first serve. That's three out of four first serves landed. And this time Fernandez cannot make the backhand return. It was very well directed down the center. And another gentle shake of the fist by the 18-year-old.
Well, we said that Emma could really take the time away from her opponent. She started doing just that, but I think Fernandez has that element of slice when she's pushed really wide.
Forehand return by Fernandez, Raducanu netting this time on the forehand.
And, you know, when I look at Fernandez's game on the defence, she can change it up a little bit. She's got the spinny forehand with height on it, but she's also got that slice on both sides, which keeps the ball low and gets through this court quite fast. And I don't think Emma's played that sort of game yet.
Backhand reply from Fernandez. Game point, Raducanu, and she seizes it. Punching that backhand cross court, showing the power that she has. And she has started superbly after Fernandez won the first point in an eye-catching way. Game, Raducanu. First game secured. Very brief change of ends as the players take a drink and I look around me in the Arthur Ashe Stadium, and it is one of the very best sights you can ever expect to see in tennis. 23,771 is the official capacity. We're not going to be very far off that at all when the last few people come in through the gangways to take their seats for this final, on a day which has already seen Joe Salisbury of Great Britain win the mixed doubles with Desiree Kravchuk of the United States, having won the men's doubles with Rajiv Ram, another American, yesterday. First man to do the doubles double at the US Open since Bob Bryan in 2010. So congratulations to him, and also to Alfie Hewitt and Gordon Reid, who won the US Open wheelchair doubles title again to complete the calendar Grand Slam. First men's doubles pair to do that in the history of wheelchair tennis. Alfie has the men's singles final to come tomorrow in the final for the fifth year in a row in New York. The first look at the Leylah Fernandez serve now, and it's a return winner by Emma Raducanu, attacking the second serve, backhand winner.
Wow, what a backhand that was. Inside out. That's took it early. Second serve of Fernandez is not particularly strong. And she certainly sent a message straight away. You missed that first serve, I'm onto it. Oh! And that first serve was about 4 feet out.
Love 15. Second serve, and that is into the net.
Love 13.
Well, that's just the pressure from the return, and it forces the double faults because Fernandez knows that she can't just throw in a regular soft second serve. She's got to do something with it.
Interesting. Raducanu's just taken a step to the left to cover that slice.
Forehand return from Raducanu, who has three break points in her first return game of the final. A miscue from Fernandez as Raducanu again returned with interest. Raducanu blows on her left palm. It's a hot day in New York, some cloud cover, around about 25, 26 degrees Celsius. As Fernandez, who's already served one double fault in this game, puts a first serve into the net. Three break points for Emma Raducanu for the dream start in her first ever Grand Slam final. Backhand return. Fernandez with the backhand down the middle. Forehand from Raducanu. Backhand Fernandez. Raducanu with the forehand, just too long.
Well, she lost that point, but I think that was a really good move for Raducanu on the return position. She was well into the tram lines, covering the lefty swinger that Fernandez has. And obviously, she's practiced that today with her coach, Andrew Richardson, who is a lefty. And I think they were working on that for a fair bit leading up to this match.
Two more break points for Raducanu. Oh. Fernandez missing her first serve. She's hoping to follow Bianca Andreescu, who is a very recent US Open women's champion for Canada. She won at the age of 19, too, here 2 years ago. Good serve. Big forehand return by Raducanu. Break point number two. Backhand down the line from Raducanu. Fernandez now hits one cross court. Forehand cross court from Raducanu. Fernandez doing so well to stay in this rally. Backhand drilled hard down the line by Raducanu. Another one's got back by Fernandez. Forehand Raducanu. Now Fernandez cross court and stepping up the pace. Forehand again from Fernandez. What a brilliant point. She was hanging on for dear life. Her serve on the line. And she saved the second of three break points in her opening service game of the final.
I think that's such an important point for Fernandez to win, to dig deep like that, to make Emma play that extra three or four balls and to turn that around. I just think it must feel like a weight has lifted off her shoulders, that she's just in this game.
Still though, a third opportunity for Emma Raducanu to break the serve early. Fernandez into the net with the first serve. 73 in the world herself, Fernandez, let's not forget. Astonishing run she's put together in New York. Third break point for Raducanu, and she's missed the forehand return.
And the change-up serve down the middle, second serve. Just slid in a little bit. That's what the lefties' little advantage they have. It's a really nasty one on quick court like this. It just keeps chasing into your body. So you'd prefer to hit a first serve than a tricky second serve like that. Needs to fix that up a little bit.
This is the first serve from Fernandez. Another forehand from her. Raducanu running onto it, hits the forehand cross court. Drop shot from Fernandez. Raducanu with a chance. Fernandez with a lob. The drive volley from Raducanu is past Fernandez for another winner.
Very interesting time to go for a drop shot from Fernandez. She had the point. I think let the ball bounce up a bit too high when she tried to hit that. It was over the shoulder, really difficult shot, but good reading from Emma coming forward, and she's so confident on those drive volleys.
Break point number four for a two love lead in the first set of the women's final from New York. But Leylah Fernandez again finds an answer, as she has been throughout the last 2 weeks. That time with an ace, many times it's by winning the most astonishing rallies.
And I'm just laughing to myself a bit, because we've been talking pre-match about how calm Emma's coach is and how collected he is on the side of the court. This is second game, he's on his feet already. It's all gone out the window.
I wonder what Andrew Richardson is thinking. Until recently, head performance coach at Culford School in Bury St. Edmunds. Former tour player, doubles player. Yeah, very, very talented player. His former coach, Dave Sammel, was telling me the other day. That's into the net, the second double fault of the game by Fernandez, and a fifth break point now for Emma Raducanu. And here he is, having spent the last 6 or 7 weeks with Emma Raducanu, potentially on the verge of being the coach who delivers a US Open title. Fifth break point, Raducanu. Fernandez, good deep serve. Backhand Fernandez. Raducanu with a forehand. Fernandez with a forehand. Raducanu hits the forehand. A little bit short this time. Fernandez clubs the backhand deep. And that's into the net from Raducanu.
I do think the double faults from Fernandez are because Emma's positioning is really covering that lefty swinger. And so she's forced into going for that flat one more than she wants to. And I almost think she could go for the straight body serve, because Emma's return is phenomenal when she has that angle to work with.
Juice, and that's a miscue on the service return by Raducanu, a backhand into the base of the net. And she's going to have to deal with the majority of the support heading Leylah Fernandez's way. It's not that they're pulling against Emma Raducanu at all, but they are certainly with the young Canadian in the early stages, as you would expect, given the geographical proximity. Easier for Canadians to travel last minute to New York than it is for British people, as Emma Raducanu's parents have found out, if they were indeed trying to make a last minute trip to New York. If you don't have a visa, no chance of getting one. You also need a national interest exemption to get into the country, and that takes at least a few days. Forehand from Raducanu. She's game point down now. She's reaching for another forehand. Fernandez goes down the line and misses. That was her chance to finally escape with her serve intact, having saved five break points. Instead, it's juice for a fourth time.
Great defensive slice forehand from Raducanu. She was really in trouble there, but she managed to throw a racket out and do a squash shot, skid it back low enough, just enough. And Fernandez just a little anxious there, racing up to the ball a little quick.
Juice again. Forehand return by Raducanu. It was a good body serve by Fernandez. Backhand from Raducanu. Backhand again from Raducanu. Onto the backhand of Fernandez. Fernandez makes room for the off forehand, which he's placed brilliantly and close to the sideline. Now the drive volley by the Canadian. Raducanu has just missed on the run. Chasing into a backhand corner. High, floaty backhand. 4 or 5 feet over the baseline.
Advantage Fernandez.
Oh, that could have been the fifth break point though. That was super close from Fernandez. The inside out forehand looked a little bit off when she hit it and just somehow managed to graze the sideline.
Well, they are both going for it in the early stages, which is the way they played their tennis over the last couple of weeks in the Big Apple. Game point again for Fernandez. Alette. So two serves to come. Long service game, but then she seems to have boundless reserves of energy. Last four matches have all gone to three sets.
Oh!
That voice is a recording. Electronic line calling, pre-recorded calling. No line judges, in the interest of accuracy. And presentation as well, part of the USTA's thinking. I think it looks nice and clean without the line judges on court. That's long from Fernandez, and on we go in this game. This will be a fifth juice coming up here. First game, Raducanu. Feels like a long time ago now. She held to 30 to win the opening game of the women's singles final on 5 Live, having opted to serve after Leylah Fernandez lost the toss. We're into the 10th minute of this game now. Fernandez, a very deep serve. Now a backhand onto the forehand of Raducanu. She didn't quite get all of that, Raducanu. Fernandez peppering the baseline, hitting powerfully from the far end as I watch on from the position high up in the Arthur Ashe Stadium. Backhand from Fernandez down the middle. The forehand from Raducanu. Backhand wide, Fernandez. It will be another break point. She's had to be patient. She's had to hang in there and show some formidable defence, Emma Raducanu. But here is the opportunity once again. It will be a sixth break point of Leylah Fernandez's opening service game.
And this is just reminding me a little bit of the third game that we saw against Shelby Rogers, where Emma had to dig really deep to win it and then went on a huge run.
Deep backhand return does the job for Raducanu as Fernandez nets. Dream start for the qualifier.
Yeah, great game there. She just to put the pressure on Fernandez. Just obviously, Fernandez came out the first few points pretty nervous there in that game. She got a, of course, Raducanu had a love 40, fought her way back, and you know, that just sends a signal to the opponent that your service games are going to be brutal.
Oh!
Raducanu's done very well at looking after her own serve in these championships so far. She's only been broken 5 times in the main draw in 6 matches. Those are very impressive numbers indeed. Misses her first serve, lands her second, pushes a forehand down the line. Now the slice backhand, the ball very low on the court. Great rally. And after Fernandez slides one down the line, Raducanu nets as she tries to go cross court with the backhand.
I think important for Emma to just get low on the slice and go top spin back cross court, get it back into the rally that she wants. I don't think she wants to be sitting in these sort of cat and mouse rallies with Fernandez, who I feel has a bit more feel around the ball.
Oh.
And looking back at that match against Tomjanovic in the fourth round of Wimbledon, there was a lot of backhand slice cross-court rallies which did Emma no good. She's best off when she takes the time away from her opponent.
Second serve, love 15 down, Raducanu, but a break up. Fernandez hits the backhand down the line. Raducanu's backhand cross court, forehand from Fernandez. Raducanu with a forehand, pushes it back onto the forehand of Fernandez. She tries to improvise, but she can't quite return that forehand in play. Very quick thinking by Emma Raducanu.
And it's a forehand down the line again. She's wrong-footed Fernandez a couple of times now, and she's looked a little bit awkward getting back there and defensively having to try and slice the ball back. She's done a pretty good job at it so far, getting it back, but not that time.
15 all, backhand reply from Fernandez. Backhand drill down the middle by Raducanu. A backhand down the line now. Fernandez keeps this rally alive, but Raducanu keeps on hitting hard down the line on the backhand and eventually gets her reward as Fernandez goes long.
I mean, the Raducanu backhand has just been superb the whole tournament, especially that down the line. She just hits it so clean, but it's nice and high over the net. It still feels like a really high percentage shot.
30-15, Raducanu with the early break on 5 Live, leading already by 2 games to love. Missing a few first serves in this game, but the scoreboard has a very comforting look for her, albeit with a long way to go. Fernandez came from a set and 4-2 down to beat a 3-time Grand Slam champion and Angelique Kerber earlier in the championships. Forehand from Raducanu, backhand Fernandez, forehand Raducanu. Fernandez cross court with a forehand. Raducanu misses wide with the backhand.
I think there's a good play there from Fernandez. Go straight down the middle until you get the short ball. As I've talked about, I think, you know, the play, it's difficult to create angles when the ball comes straight down the middle hard at you. And that's so Emma's very, very good once she gets a wide swing at the ball.
30 all. Oh. That was a big miss from Raducanu. You're listening to the 1987 Wimbledon champion Pat Cash, Laura Robson, who reached the fourth round of the US Open as an 18-year-old and is an Olympic silver medalist.
Second service.
Second serve. Can Raducanu consolidate that break of serve and move into a 3-love lead? Backhand hit very hard in return by Fernandez, who's on the baseline, hitting the forehand deep. Raducanu just a little bit long, just the wrong side of the baseline. And now she will have to fight off her first break point of this final.
Also really interesting to see Raducanu go quite wide with the position on the serve. She's leaving that down the line backhand open for Fernandez, but she obviously wants to be able to hit the angle that she wants on the serve. It's tricky to balance that.
Break that point, Fernandez. High backhand return into the net. Serve down the tee, down the middle of this blue court with its enormous green surrounds and runoff areas in New York.
And like she's done all tournament, just under pressure, come up with a great serve. Her favourite one down the middle, lower part of the net.
Juice. Forehand return, Fernandez. Backhand, Raducanu is into the net. That was an error, and she's break point down for the second time. Just gone 4:30 in the afternoon here in New York. 9:38. In the UK on 5 Live. Raducanu, break point down in this game for a second time. Backhand return from Fernandez. Forehand Raducanu. Backhand Fernandez. Forehand Raducanu cross court. Fernandez goes down the line. It hits the tape. It springs to the back of the court. Raducanu, break point down, hits the forehand to the forehand of Fernandez. Raducanu's backhand. Fernandez with the backhand into the net.
Oof, these points are tough. They're both working so hard here. Raducanu just coming out on top in all these long rallies, though. Really positive sign for her. But, you know, Fernandez trying to mix things up a little bit, added some height on the forehand.
Well, they've come to play, haven't they? Neither seem inhibited in the early stages in a first Grand Slam final, which must seem scarcely believable to them. And maybe that helps them play the way they're able to. Juice for a second time in this game. Second serve now for Raducanu. She just waits for that one loud voice to quieten down. Backhand cross court from Fernandez. Great return. She's got a very short ball to put away. And she wasn't going to miss an opportunity like that. She's fighting hard to get the break back. This will be her third opportunity.
Fernandez.
And Raducanu saved all 7 break points that she faced against Sakkari in the semi-finals with these big first serves.
Can she save another one? The court now completely in the shadow of the roof over the Arthur Ashe Stadium. A giant white-coloured construction, 62 metres above the court surface. Very much open today, as it will be for the men's final on 5 Live tomorrow. Break point down, Raducanu. Misses her first serve. Novak Djokovic chasing history, going for the calendar Grand Slam. Will he be the first man to do so since Rod Laver in 1969? Find out against Daniil Medvedev from 9 tomorrow. Break point down, it's saved again by Raducanu. Second serve, Fernandez will ruin missed opportunity there as she nets.
Well, I'm surprised by that miss by Fernandez, because she's been so clutch in these situations. Under pressure, just has been excellent at making balls. It's the hardest thing to do when you're feeling tight.
Good surprise serve there, wasn't it? Second serve out to the forehand. Very clever.
Juice. Raducanu. Oh! Serves a double fault. That's her first double fault of this final so far. And it will be a fourth. break point for Fernandez after Raducanu converted her sixth break point in the previous game. Well, we're getting our money's worth, aren't we?
Let's first service.
The first set of some finals are over by now. 22 minutes on the clock. Thinking of Karolina Pliskova. Poor thing, losing the first 14 points of the Wimbledon final to Ash Barty 6 or 7 weeks ago. Break point down again, Raducanu. Forehand is hit to the back of the court with a little bit of air. Backhand into the net from Raducanu. The screen is from the Canadian. Leylah Fernandez, well played, bites back immediately. Was it ever in doubt? She's a great front runner and she's very dangerous when she's behind as well. But effectively, we're all square now, Gigi. Yes, Emma Raducanu leads by 2-1, but we're back on serve in the first set of the final.
22 minutes on the clock of the final. You continue to get in touch with us. Thank you for doing so. Keep doing so at 5 Live if you'd like to join in the conversation. Jane, listening in anticipation on my narrow boat in Droitwich Spa. Even the roosting ducks are quacking in unison. I'm sure they're all rooting for her. Mike, you asked where we're listening from. My garden sauna in Derbyshire. Lee is listening in the car on the way back from Stamford Bridge. Mandy, my partner Lynn and I are listening from our little caravan in the wilds of the west coast of Scotland. Shane Warne, come on, Emma Raducanu, you've got this. Marcus Rashford said, yes, Emma Raducanu, let's go. Then he's been chatting with Gary Lineker because Match of the Day is on BBC One at 10:40 this evening. He said, do us a favour and push it back if the tennis is on. So far, no reply from Gary Lineker. If you missed the football today, I mentioned Stamford Bridge, the Chelsea 3-0 winners at home to Aston Villa. Cristiano Ronaldo, a brace for him on his return to United and Old Trafford. 4-1 winners in the end against Newcastle. The shock of the day, the early match, Crystal Palace beat Tottenham by 3-0. Arsenal picked up 3 points, beating Norwich at home 1-0. Leicester lost at home 1-0 Manchester City. Let's get through these for you. Goalless Southampton and West Ham. Wolves won 2-0 away to Watford and Brighton won 1-0 away to Brentford. As things stand, Match of the Day still on at 10:40. I'll let you know if that changes. Now let's get back. Fourth game, first set, women's final, US Open.
And talking of footballers, I'm sure Tim Hemman won't mind me telling this story. When I was interviewing him, a call flashed up on his phone from Jamie Redknapp as Raducanu puts a backhand into the net. Good serve into the body there by Leylah Fernandez. And he was just telling me how Jamie Redknapp has just been absolutely thrilled by this US Open, and in particular the run of Emma Raducanu. Just an example of people who perhaps wouldn't normally watch a great deal of tennis, may not watch a great deal of women's tennis, but their lives have been transformed over the past couple of weeks. Backhand hit very hard by Raducanu, very well dealt with by Fernandez, absorbing the pace so well, and Raducanu's netting. And at the moment, Fernandez on a little bit of a roll.
Here's an inside-out forehand again, Laura, that almost looks like it's mishit a little bit, isn't it?
It sort of comes over the shoulder, doesn't it? And a classic inside out is the low to high that you learn when you're young. But Fernandez really gets that angle and hits it almost down and inside out. It's effective, but it's
it's risky, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But got to say, Raducanu chased that down. She is incredibly quick.
Big forehand return by Raducanu, but it's dealt with by Fernandez. And now onto the baseline, Raducanu. A forehand from her, drop shot Fernandez. Oh, that was just lovely. Saw Raducanu a little bit too far back, and she played that from about a foot or two inside her own baseline with such style and class and touch.
Well, that's the place to play. That's the time to play the drop shot. The one previously was really made a loser service game, really. That one was, as you said, inside the service line where she hit it, and then she just dribbled it over the net nicely. No chance for
three
Emma
game
to
points.
Chase that down.
And if Fernandez can take one of them, it'll be 2-2 in the first set of this final. Good serve from Fernandez. Backhand from her, squatting down as she plays it. Now Raducanu trying to come forward behind the forehand, hits the sideline, she's coming in towards the net, smashes the drive volley away.
I do think the difference for Raducanu is that when she hits those big returns down the middle of the court, which have been so effective, that's when you see Fernandez drop into that super low squat position that you see someone like Kerber do, Radwanska used to do it, and just return the pace, not adding anything But Emma's last few opponents haven't had that skill.
That is onto the baseline from Raducanu. Fernandez needs to keep playing and try and close out this game. There's a lob from Raducanu, a defensive one, and a drive volley from Fernandez, which I'm sure she didn't need to hit. And she's missed, and Raducanu's still in the game.
That was definitely going wide.
40-30.
Just have to let that one drop. I think because Fernandez tried to go around it and hit the forehand, she thought it was closer than it really was.
Still a point for two games all for Fernandez. Good serve down the middle.
Game Fernandez.
Service winner. We love Leylah from the Philippines, says one homemade sign. Mum Irene with Filipino roots, although was born in Canada. Dad Jorge staying away for superstitious reasons. A former Ecuador international footballer looking after the rest of the family, wearing the same jeans, socks, and underwear that he has for the last couple of weeks, as we were hearing at the start of the show. Two games all. Backhand reply from Fernandez. Forehand from Raducanu. Fernandez's forehand. Backhand hit so hard and so crisply by Raducanu. Now she goes cross court. Brilliant from Fernandez. Down the line, backhand winner.
And I'm looking at this match now, and I just think, how important was it for Fernandez to win that two-love game, get herself on the board? And since then, she's played much looser. She's added pace on the backhand. She's going for her shots a bit more. And it doesn't look like she's overwhelmed by Raducanu's pace at the back of the court. If it was three-love, that's an entirely different story.
Yeah, she seemed to be dealing with the pace, isn't she? It's playing Sabalenka in the last match. She get plenty of practice, the opponent hitting the ball like a bullet.
Double fault, Emma Raducanu. She's loved 30 down now at 2-all, and she's facing some relentless pressure for the moment from Leylah Fernandez, who's reminding us just how she can play, and this is exactly what she has done to Grand Slam champions like Naomi Osaka and Angelique Kerber. Backhand return from Fernandez. Forehand Raducanu onto the baseline. Bold hitting. Opportune moment to find the baseline.
15-30.
Yep, hard and flat, straight down the line. And that's her backhand down the line, and the forehand down the line are going to do the damage today. If she can get that on target.
Backhand is wide by Fernandez. Good serving from Raducanu. Back to 30 all in this game. And a spectacular final is what this women's championship deserves. The men's draw has been a joy to watch as well. It has been a jaw-droppingly good US Open. 30 all, Raducanu serving in the Arthur Ashe Stadium on 5 Live. She's found another good serve, and she's starting to use her voice a little bit more now.
Virginia Wade's in attendance.
And I spotted Andy Roddick earlier as well, another champion at the US Open. Virginia Wade champion in 1968, last British woman to win the title. Raducanu serves down the middle, high return long from Fernandez. Four outstanding points from Love 30, just as Fernandez was starting to make her presence felt, Gigi.
Thank you very much, Ross. David Laura, part of the 5 Live tennis team. David, your thoughts, 5 games and 30 minutes into this final.
Well, My thoughts are how refreshing and rare it is to see two players come out onto a Grand Slam stage and immediately start firing and just going for it and being totally uninhibited and playing well from the off. So often you see players overcome with the occasion, and understandably so. I couldn't handle it. I couldn't, no chance. And I think so few people, especially when they're making their debuts on these sort of stages, would be able to handle this. And these two young women have come out and played exactly as they played all tournament long. And watching them go toe-to-toe like this is really something. And it's a fantastic moment for the sport, really. Long may that continue.
It certainly is. Mandy and Steve, and they're in the car travelling from Cornwall to Norfolk, gripped by this game and the commentary and bearded hero, together with Joy, say come on Emma, listening by our fire pit in Devon. Do get in touch with us. Where are you listening? What are you up to? How are you going to celebrate should Emma Raducanu come through this? It's a wonderful atmosphere. It's a great crowd. It's been a gripping, it really has, first five games with Five Live Tennis, the women's final at the US Open, and still everything very much to play for.
3-2. Emma Raducanu leads. We're on serve after a break apiece in the opening skirmishes of this first set of the 2021 US Open Women's Singles Final. First Grand Slam final between two teenagers since Serena Williams beat Martina Hingis here in the final Grand Slam of the last century. First time in the Open era since 1968 there's been a Grand Slam final between two unseeded players. Fernandez into the net with the backhand after a good-looking service return by Raducanu, who has that determined look on her face as she makes her way along the baseline, pumping her fist, blowing on the left palm of her hand again. It's a sticky day in New York, likely to be considerably hotter and more humid tomorrow for the men's final. Raducanu with a forehand, that's a disappointing error. She's pushed that one over the baseline when she looked like she was in a position to go on the attack.
Both of them have hit 9 unforced errors so far. I think most of those came on the two love game for Emma. Just such a long game.
Two, three. 15 all. Second serve for Leylah Fernandez, and she's put that one into the net.
15-13.
So a third double fault, which I think is entirely understandable, but could be significant, Pat.
Yeah, she's going to have to tidy that up because Emma's done a great job. I said in the very first service game, stepping up there. It was the very first point, maybe, stepping up there and smashing the second serve down. That's just put a little bit of doubt in Fernandez's head. Raducanu's got a better service technique that'll be more consistent, you would think. Another second serve here.
At 15-30, forehand from Raducanu, a backhand from Raducanu. Backhand cross-court Fernandez into the corner of the court and just missing. Raducanu was just trying to steer that forehand down the line.
30 all.
And that's when you play with nothing to lose. As you're looking at it, she's throwing her head back, looked up to the sky there because she feels like, you know, that was a shot. Should I have gone for that or not? I mean, she has been going for it and they've been going in. That's the freewheeling that she's been doing this tournament. That time didn't miss by much. But it would have hit the target. There was two break points right there.
Still 30 all and a second serve. Heading her way from the racket of the left-handed Leylah Fernandez. Forehand into the net from Emma Raducanu.
It's a risky serve, though, for Fernandez. She's missed that one a few times in the net. I think has to lift the first serve percentage on the juice side in particular, because Emma's just getting into those points and it's creating that tension for Fernandez on the serve.
Game point, Fernandez.
Yeah, the second serve is pretty flat, isn't it? Mm. Just skims over the net. She's not tall. So she hasn't got the height.
This is the second serve for her.
Second service.
Well, it doesn't skim over
can
the net.
Hear. No. Little bit of contact. A little noise. A bleep. And the words of Marijana Veljevic of Serbia, our chair umpire. Fernandez hits the forehand. Oh, very lucky indeed. Hits the tape. Springs over. Both hands up in abject, in quotes, apology.
She's got
and Leylah Fernandez holds for three all.
She's got the biggest smile on her face. She couldn't. She pretended that she wasn't happy about that, but she.
Yeah, it's sort of a dumb thing in tennis, isn't it, to apologise after a net call, but you never mean it.
She kind of felt guilty, I think. She turned around, put her hand over her mouth, but could not stop the smile.
I always love when you see someone say sorry and then turn around and fist pump.
Yes, come on.
Three games all.
Big point, so pretty happy about that.
Yeah, otherwise we'd be at juice. So, Raducanu's turn again to serve. This will be a second serve at the start of game number 7 on 5 Live. First set of the women's singles final from the US Open. Leylah Fernandez in the middle of the court, slicing a backhand. Good defence from Raducanu, but that was really well finished off by Fernandez. Always in control of the rally, standing commandingly at the net and hitting a deep slice backhand volley away into the corner.
That was good composure there because she had the short ball. It was low. She couldn't hit a topspin on that one for an approach shot. So she did the slice and hit it very, very nicely. Not a lot Emma could do with that. Just sort of get it back and hope that she could get it down low. But Fernandez was on top of the net by then.
Love 15. Raducanu onto the backhand of Fernandez. Backhand Raducanu. Backhand from Fernandez. Forehand from Raducanu. It lands in midcourt. Fernandez hits deep. Raducanu now working her way back into the rally. Forehand onto the forehand of Fernandez, which is hit with a little bit of air. Not cleanly struck, but Fernandez is still very much in this point. Raducanu hits the forehand to the slice backhand of Fernandez. Raducanu has plenty of time. Doesn't go quite deep enough. The volley, though, will win her the point.
Huge point for Emma to not go love 30 down.
15-0.
Fernandez was hitting with so much depth there, but just again went for the drop shot. I think at the wrong time, quite a difficult ball to change the pace on, and didn't get the one that she wanted, and just landed inside the service line. So Emma was well up to that, but finished the point well with the volley.
3-0. 15-0, forehand Raducanu down the line. Fernandez has no alternative but to send up a high lob. The drive volley from Raducanu, another lob from Fernandez. It'll be another drive volley, and she's missed this one, Raducanu. Decided not to take it out of the air with the smash. Went for the drive volley. Tricky shot, Pat.
15-30.
Yeah, it is, because the second one was really high and it was coming down almost directly down, which is tough. Yeah, it was a... If she'd gone back for the smash, she would have been right back to the baseline. So, you know, she's got to play aggressively. I think that was the right shot. She just didn't quite connect it.
15-30 down.
Oh!
Three games all. First set of the final. As Raducanu tries to win the title as a qualifier. Forehand into the net from Fernandez. So... that was one that she would like to have back.
Second time she's done that one, isn't
yeah,
she?
Yeah, a second time she's done it, and she tried to take the ball early and tried to do the right things, but it's just going too flat that it's clipping the net. And, you know, it's the right play, but I think her forehand works best when it does have a bit of topspin on it.
3-all, 30-all, and that is just good from Raducanu as she went cross-court with the backhand. Now she's smashing a forehand down the line, getting on top of the high ball very skillfully. And it's game point for 4-3.
40-30.
This is great composure. The last couple of points, I mean, the first one, going out to that that forehand, the forehand side on the second serve was very, very good. And that one, again, just working the point, getting the short forehand. When it's short, you got to go for it.
Game point Raducanu, who just on occasions is not quite happy with her ball toss, catches the ball, gives herself a few seconds, serves down the middle, forehand Raducanu, backhand from Fernandez, forehand Raducanu, Fernandez with the forehand, Raducanu will hit the backhand to the forehand of the left-handed Leylah Fernandez of Canada. Good depth from Fernandez, brilliant extra pace from Raducanu, who's now hitting the off forehand onto the sideline. Amazing defense from Fernandez. Raducanu cross court with the forehand to try and finish the rally, and Fernandez can't make it from there.
What a rally.
Not even Leylah Fernandez can retrieve it from there. Many people standing in front of me. A service hold for Emma Raducanu, a thrilling first set, still very much in the balance, with Raducanu leading as she sits down in her chair by 4-3.
Now, John Aldridge is joining in with Marcus Rashford about match of the day, just not being on, just ignore it. He said, can't watch match of the day tonight, folks. You know it makes sense. So the alternative is the young and gifted Raducanu in the tennis final. She just said at the moment it's 10:40 on BBC One, but Marcus Rashford is trying to get Gary Lineker to move the time. I'm not sure if that's even possible. He can do that, but he has asked the question. Pat, the question I was going to ask you is... the most games that Emma Raducanu has dropped in a set to this point in the main body of the tournament, so through six matches, now the seventh, is 4. That's where we're at now. It's going to be interesting this part of the set because she's never face substantial scoreline pressure in a set?
Well, there's one way to solve that problem is to break, serve and hold. That's what she's been doing the whole time. And she's been incredibly composed. I mean, it's that last rally was absolutely sensational. She was in trouble, ran wide to a forehand and hit it straight back down the line, which is a really tough shot. So she's seeing the ball incredibly well. I mean, it is a real battle, and the difference between the two players, I think, is Fernandez at the moment had just missed a couple of big second serve opportunities with forehands. And that Fernandez is just getting those extra balls back that I think Raducanu hasn't seen as yet. But, you know, there's very, very little in this. And, you know, this is a massive, massive game. I mean, if you can get up a set in the final, I tell you what, you're. I don't know what the percentages are, but you know, this first set is absolutely crucial for both players. I think whoever gets the first set is going to win the match.
Leylah Fernandez misses a first serve. She's the one feeling a little bit more pressure at the moment because she's 3-4 down. She's the one playing catch up and serving second. Double fault.
Number
fourth
four.
Of the match.
It's becoming a problem.
It looks like on the second serve that her racket head speed is just slowing down a bit too much, and it seems like she's overthinking where to play that one. Wants to go for the lefty swinger, but knows that's the one that Raducanu's going to be covering. Oh, that's a fantastic response, though. Ace down the middle.
The first ace of the match. Second ace of the match, correction. Timing. 15 all. The double fault is history. She hopes. First serve into the net. Second serve from Fernandez. 44 minutes played on the Arthur Ashe Stadium. Forehand cross-court return by Raducanu. Stretching Fernandez somewhere she did not want to be, and she cannot make that forehand return.
And Fernandez just needs to pick up the first serve percentage a bit. It's sitting at 45% right now, and it's really difficult. It's putting so much pressure on her second. And, you know, Emma's moving inside the baseline, taking the return early.
15-30 on the Fernandez serve, and the first serve once again finds the net. Second serve. Hit by Fernandez, forehand Raducanu, forehand from Fernandez, Raducanu's backhand reaching for that. Fernandez now inside the baseline, swings one cross court, nicely done. Raducanu on the run, makes contact between racket and ball, but the forehand was always running away from her.
Well, game very, very brave there, Fernandez. She didn't ease back at all. Second serve was still hit hard. It's becoming a little bit of an issue, the serve, so it was pretty brave to do that and then drill the next two in either corner.
This is a big point in the final at 30 all. It's a good serve by Fernandez. High return from Raducanu. She's now going to hit the forehand away, Fernandez. Just waited for Emma Raducanu to commit to her forehand side. And hit that forehand down the line. And 1 point away from making it 4 games all in the first set. Leylah Fernandez, the more extroverted of the two. She was the player who, when she was a lot younger, liked to perform in plays and at concerts at school, and certainly feeds here off the crowd's energy.
I just think that was great composure from Fernandez to wait for Emma to pick a side.
40-30, second serve, forehand return from Raducanu, backhand from Raducanu, forehand Fernandez, ooh, that was a wild one, and so we are at deuce.
Yes. And it's the inside-out forehand again for Fernandez, where it just looks like she's not getting around the ball enough, not getting enough shoulder turn to be able to hit the shot that she wants to. I think she really is better off going for the cross-court lefty swinger that gets Emma so far out.
First deuce since the third game of the final. Fernandez makes room for a forehand and just gloriously whacks that down the line. If you can whack anything gloriously, but it was a fantastic shot. Great foot movement, her advantage.
Yeah, bit of footwork there, getting around. This time listening to Laura's advice and saying, you know, I'm going to go down the line on this one. I'm in slightly better position, not inside out.
She She has the advantage, and the backhand is long by Raducanu. So how are we going to separate these two players? Four games all first set.
Well, I am just in awe of both of these players coming out here and performing like this in their first ever Grand Slam. You would think they've been here many, many times before. And I don't think it's fair to compare, but I do think back to that first set at Wimbledon where it was just not competitive at all with Pliskova and Barty. But both of these players have come out and have played the game that's got them to the final. Oh. It's not easy to do.
No, it's incredibly impressive standard at the moment. The odd mistake, but really not much in it.
Second serve, a really good one from Raducanu. Her backhand cross court is out of the reach of the on-rushing Fernandez.
Great
one meeting between these two, not officially counting on their records because it was at Junior Wimbledon in 2018. Raducanu won 6-2, 6-4 in the second round and lost to Iga Swiatek, who'd go on to win the French Open a couple of years later in the quarterfinals. They met at the Orange Bowl, the prestigious junior competition in Florida, 7 years ago. And got talking because they realised they had Canada in common, with Raducanu having spent the first couple of years of her life in Toronto. Not that she was probably able to bring too much colour to the conversation. There's a little drop shot again from Fernandez, and this is well reached by Raducanu. She's netted. I thought she played that beautifully, Fernandez, but Raducanu showing a really good set of wheels as she made her way across the court.
She's quick. That was a good drop shot there. Emma was way behind the court, probably 6 feet out to the forehand side. The drop shot was a pretty good shot, but she got there with ease. She'd be kicking herself, in actual fact, for missing that, and didn't miss by much, just hit the white strap at the top of the net.
15-all with Emma Raducanu serving up four games all in the first set of the US Open final on 5 Live. Now 30-15, high and long with the forehand return is Leylah Fernandez.
It's a 1-2 punch, isn't it? Wide serve followed by the forehand down the line. It's been very effective with down the line shots again from Raducanu.
30-15. We do have all boys and girls, despite the absence of line judges. But as I've said before, on our coverage from New York, they tend to be anything but boys and girls in New York. They'll take any age. Great hitting again by Raducanu. She's got a very short ball to put away here. Lets it bounce, works the backhand cross court. Now she'll need to make the volley. Fernandez is still in this point. And has she hit the baseline? No, not quite. Emma Raducanu is putting her arm up instinctively to try and challenge the call, but there was a call, a close call, as the big screen tells us. We get a replay for those inside the stadium, but it was probably about three quarters of a ball width too long. But if Leylah Fernandez had won that point, as Jeff Tarango always said, there would have been a standing O inside the Arthur Ashe Stadium.
How quick is Fernandez? Just to even get a racket on that ball. I don't know how she recovers so quickly. She reads the game so early. Oh.
Two game points for Raducanu, though. This is second serve, this to move within one game of the first set. She serves onto the forehand of Fernandez. Backhand from Raducanu. Forehand from Fernandez. It's long. Raducanu just standing there waiting for it. Knew it was long. Saw the ball land the other side of the baseline. And she can continue her smart march to her chair. Pick up her towel. Sit down. And think about how she's going to break the Leylah Fernandez serve, Gigi, which would give her the first set of the final.
Well, it's incredible to think, Laura, that the longest set Emma Raducanu had played coming into this final was 51 minutes. We're now at 50, so this will be the longest set of tennis that she's played at this year's US Open, which has shown just how precisely and concisely she's been getting through her rounds.
And I just took a look back at all the scores that she's had in this tournament, and she hasn't had a 7-5 set since the second round of qualifying, which was actually her toughest match so far of the tournament, which is hard to believe. But, you know, Fernandez, I think, is looking a bit more comfortable on her serve. The errors are coming from the forehand side. I'm sure Emma's noticing that too, where that 1-2 punch is really working well, where Fernandez is reading it, getting a racket on it, but has that awkward grip on the forehand side where she can't always get over the ball. And that's when we've seen the errors come in with the inside out specifically, where she almost hits it with too much shoulder rather than full body rotation, which you want to see. But it's just been fantastic tennis so far, and I'm enjoying myself. This is so fun. Time.
Richard Conway has tweeted, anyone else just spot Larry David in the background at the US Open? I would pay good money to hear his commentary. And that's the thing, Ross. It's especially when you get to the finals at the US Open, it's a who's who in terms of who's in the crowd.
Yeah, where were they on the first Tuesday?
Thank you.
Fair weather.
We had
fans.
Ben Stiller, didn't we, on the first Wednesday. He came to watch Diego Schwartzman in the match that was abandoned on the Armstrong court, despite the roof, because the strong winds were blowing torrential rain inside the stadium. And he stayed until 3 o'clock in the morning to watch Schwartzman eventually beat Kevin Anderson once the match was resumed on the Arthur Ashe Stadium, which is where I am here on Five Live to watch whether Leylah Fernandez can serve to stay in the first set of the final against Emma Raducanu. It's 4-5 on the Canadian serve, and the lob doesn't come off the middle of the strings by Raducanu. It bounces before the net. First point successfully negotiated as Fernandez serves to stay in the set.
Oh, a great serve, literally on the tee, right down the middle, pulling Raducanu out wide. And then hit the backhand across court on the line again. Two lines in a row. Certainly not being phased at this stage. He's still going for the shot. And it is a big, big game, this one. Absolutely massive.
Second serve, Fernandez. Forehand return by Raducanu. And that's long by Fernandez. A little bit cramped for room.
15-0.
Again, the pressure on the second serve. Fernandez needs to get the first serve percentage up. Every time, it just looks like she's even shaky going into the action on the second.
Backhand return from Raducanu at 15-all. Backhand cross-court hit by the British player right onto the sideline, and that will be long from Fernandez. So 15-30 here. Emma Raducanu 2 points away from the first set.
That backhand came from almost nowhere. It was a good old shot from Fernandez. It was deep. It wasn't particularly wide, and Raducanu got that angle wide. It was just phenomenal. And hit the line.
Fernandez serves at 15-30, serves into the net.
Now the second.
Second serve, backhand reply, winner! Raducanu goes cross court. And she has two set points.
Now you can feel it coming. Raducanu looking so positive in her positioning inside the baseline before she even hit that ball.
Thank you.
Set point number one to Raducanu. Forehand return. Fernandez hits the forehand. Raducanu with a backhand. Fernandez with a forehand, but you heard the call. It was so close. But Raducanu just pushed it long, and she immediately turned back to those in her box that include her coach, Andrew Richardson, and Will Herbert, the LTA physio, and her agent, Chris Hellier. She couldn't believe it. Fine, fine margins, but Fernandez has saved the first of two set points. Set point number two for Raducanu. Backhand return. Great return from her. Excellent two from Fernandez, who's coming to the net to hit the forehand. Raducanu with the lob. Fernandez is running back. It's landed just the wrong side of the sideline.
Right shot to play. Fernandez is on top of the net. Hasn't done an awful lot wrong. Just a first little sense of nerves on that first break point. Raducanu is only up by an inch or two.
Well done, Leylah Fernandez. Two set points saved. Forehand from the Canadian. That is long. There'll be a third set point now for Emma Raducanu.
Advantage, Raducanu.
Fernandez has to make the first serve here. Emma's backhand return cross court has been firing, but Emma's just, for me, showing a few signs of stress here, looking up at her box quite a bit more than she was at the start of the match.
Set point number three for her, though, as Fernandez puts a first serve into the net. second serve. Third opportunity for Raducanu to win the first set. Backhand reply into the net.
Oh, she had it.
She had it. That was a good serve, though, from Fernandez. They're not going for the line, just going to slide, do that lefty serve into the body, jam her up a little bit. Emma's been so good when she gets a swing at the ball with a bit of room. So a clever play from Fernandez. A massive second serve.
It's juice. She's got a first serve in play, Fernandez. Her forehand is on the backhand of Raducanu. Backhand Fernandez. Forehand Raducanu. Fernandez on the defense. Hits the forehand. Raducanu with the off forehand. Fernandez reaching for everything, but it'll be set point number four because the forehand has landed wide.
Advantage, Raducanu.
Surely this one is Emma's. She's the one going for the ball. I think Fernandez has taken a bit of pace off from the baseline, and Emma's the one dictating the rallies now. Can
yeah,
she make this
hitting,
backhand
she?
Return, though? I feel like you know where the serve is going here.
Set point number four. It's a high backhand return from Raducanu, which is in. It was an excellent serve by Fernandez. Raducanu's in the rally now. Hits the forehand cross court. Raducanu with a shorter ball. She goes cross court with a forehand. Fernandez hitting hard. Raducanu down the line with a forehand winner to win the first set of the US Open final in only the second Grand Slam of her career. And she's taking it out of the Leylah Fernandez playbook now. She wants to hear more noise from the Arthur Ashe Stadium. She's one set away from becoming a Grand Slam champion at the age of just 18.
High quality, high drama, absolutely stunning. You must stay with us. She has now, Emma Raducanu, won 19 straight sets of tennis coming through the first round of qualifying. Leylah Fernandez is going to take a comfort break. She's going to leave the court. She has, though, on two occasions through this run, come from a set down, once against defending champion Naomi Osaka and once against the 2016 champion Angelique Kerber. So still very much everything to play for. Stay with us here on 5 Live. But now the time at 18 minutes past 10. Let's get some news with Dan Maudsley.
Listen on BBC Sounds. This is BBC Radio 5 Live.
Events have been held across the world to remember those who lost their lives in the September the 11th attacks 20 years ago today. A total of 2,977 people died. In a message to President Biden, the Queen said her thoughts and prayers remained with the victims, survivors and families affected. The Prime Minister is expected to set out his COVID winter plan for England this week. It's thought it will include measures to help the NHS if the health service becomes overwhelmed. Government figures show that 156 people have died within 28 days of testing positive for COVID-19, bringing the UK total to 133,144. There were 29,557 new lab-confirmed infections. And the Doctors' Union, the British Medical Association, has warned that GPs in England are being burnt out and leaving the profession. The comments come after The Guardian reported that GPs were finding it increasingly hard to guarantee safe care for millions of patients.
BBC Five Live, the voice of the UK.
Around 9 million people in the UK struggle to read and write.
My son used to read to me and I was learning with him words. I think we learned bits of reading together.
Here at Five Live, we want to start a conversation about adult literacy.
Hearing the powerful stories of people who are speaking publicly for the first time about their struggles to read and write.
Well, I think it's important to do something with your life, and especially when it's writing and things like that, you know, just get out there and get all the help you can.
Word matters. Listen on BBC Radio 5 Live. US Open Tennis with Gigi Salmon on 5 Live.
From Flushing Meadows in New York, where Emma Raducanu is a set away from being a Grand Slam champion. Just to mark your card, 5 Live Sport tomorrow. Premier League Sunday, Leeds against Liverpool. That will be the focus from 4:30 in the afternoon. Before that, there's coverage of the Italian Grand Prix from 2 o'clock. And on Monday, it is the Monday nightclub, followed by Everton against Burnley. We're still waiting for Leylah Fernandez to return to the court, but Laura Robson, what a first set of tennis we've just witnessed.
Yeah, finally we can take a deep breath for the first time in 58 minutes, because it was just relentless hitting from both players. I think Fernandez really is making Emma play one extra ball the way that we thought she would. You know, she's a fantastic mover, but Emma just at the end of that set added a bit of pace, decided she was the one that was going to win that set, because she really did start winning the points. It wasn't Fernandez gifting it to her. And, you know, gets the first strike in almost every time. It's just whether she can sustain this now. And Fernandez has come through so many matches in three sets. I don't think she's going to be too bothered about losing that first set. As you know, she's been such a fighter in all of her matches. It's just a really fun match that we're watching, though. I'm so glad that both players have come out here and played fantastic tennis. There's been signs of nerves, but it hasn't overwhelmed them. And, you know, here we are. This is an absolute stunner of a match.
Having broken the serve of Fernandez to take the set, it's Emma Raducanu now ready to serve. And she serves down the tee and she aces for the first point of the second set. Four of Fernandez's six matches have gone the distance. They were the last four she played, and from two of them she's come from a set down. So Emma Raducanu, the qualifier, 18 years of age, serves out wide. Forehand goes cross-court, down on one knee, cross-court with the backhand from Raducanu. Then goes forehand, and you can hear the squeaky shoes of Raducanu. They just scoops that backhand into the net.
And I think a bit of a key game here for Emma Raducanu. Sometimes it's so hard to keep the level up after winning a huge set like that. And you relax almost too much. The footwork just drops off slightly.
Raducanu at 15-all serves down the tee, the slap back off forehand from Fernandez. It hits a double-handed backhand, looping a little bit short, backhand up the line from Raducanu, who steps on this backhand, goes slightly off for the backhand, middle of the court from Raducanu, goes cross-court, drops it a little bit short, just moving the backhand around, down on one knee, into the net goes Fernandez.
It's not bad. Good play from Fernandez, playing again right down the middle and then waiting for the short ball, which she got on the forehand, but didn't do really enough with it. It was reasonably short, straight onto Raducanu's backhand, who fired it straight back down the middle with extra pace.
30-15, 18 years of age, Emma Raducanu. She came in at 150 in the world. Live ranking, she's 32, wins another set, and she's the world number 23. 30-15, first game, second set, serve out wide. It's framed by Fernandez, who sort of stalks off and has a quick look up at her box, and it's game points for the Brit.
Well, that's been her saviour at the moment, that second serve out to the forehand on the ad court. It's taken Fernandez by surprise every time.
Game points. Raducanu serves out wide on the angle. She's opened up the court. She steps, she chose back behind Fernandez. Point one, game one, first game, second set for Emma Raducanu.
First game, second set.
Well, how often have we seen Emma get to this level and just run away with it? You know, when she's feeling this confident, when she's hitting the ball this well, I think she's so hard to play against, because you just never have enough time on your racket to do much with it. And I can see what Fernandez is trying to do. She's going through the middle a lot, not getting the same depth that she was at times in the first set. But, you know, any time you give Emma Raducanu a bit of an angle on the ball at the moment, she's just redirecting it so well down the line.
Well, she's holding serve. I mean, this is the advantage of serving first. The men do it, but serve first. Had to put the pressure on the opponent.
The lefty Fernandez just drags the backhand wide again. She was crouching so low that her knees are brushing the court surface. Hour and 5 minutes on the clock, 25 past five in the afternoon local time. Emma Raducanu is set away from being a Grand Slam champion in just her second Grand Slam appearance. First serve miss out wide from the left-handed Fernandez, who jumps up and down on her toes, a sleeveless navy blue top, a white skirt, white shorts under the white skirt, and white socks and shoes as she serves down the tee and clips the net.
Yeah, this is the time Emma's going to go after this one, the second serve, actually after a let.
Raducanu crouched low. She's on the baseline. A double fault for Fernandez. Her immediately swivels round her back to her opponent, and it's love 30 and the door opens.
I think her legs have gone. I think the last few matches have really taken it out of her. She's had to work so hard for them, and that first set as well was so physical.
Love 30 needs the first serve here. Serve down the tee, backhand through the middle of the court, the forehand sort of slap cross court, a little bit short from Fernandez, who steps in, scoops the forehand into the net, didn't move her feet up to the ball, and it's Love 40.
That miss hit from Raducanu turned out perfectly. It was short and awkward.
It's her 11th break point of the match, her first of the second set, and converted on just the two occasions, Raducanu. Love 40, three more opportunities here. The inside-out forehand return into the corner goes Fernandez, who plays and swings the backhand cross-court. The stretch and the lob from Raducanu. The ball will land long, and that's the first break point saved.
15.
First serve. And neither of them have served high percentage of first serves in the first set, but Raducanu's a bit better.
Fernandez with a
second serve as well.
Hair scrape back into a bun, serves out wide, forehand comes back and deep, redirects up the line, backhand winner from Fernandez.
And this is where it's going to get interesting, because if Fernandez's legs are a bit tired and she's feeling it physically, she's going to have to start to shorten the points and go for it a bit more. And, you know, that backhand down the line that we just saw, she just ripped it.
Breakpoint opportunity number three for Raducanu, 30-40, the serve out wide, it's too good, there's a roar from the 19-year-old. She turned 19 on Monday, and she's come from Love 40 to level things up at Juice.
Important now for Raducanu to get the return back into play. Credit to Fernandez, she's come up with some good serves.
Fernandez is on her toes, she settles, she bounces the ball, she rocks back, she reaches up, she serves down the tee, the ball will miss and it's game point.
Quick court, the first serve is just so important. It comes on nicely to you the first serve comes on nicely if you don't hit the target, because of course you use, as a returner, you use the serve as pace.
Game point serve out wide, and there's the roar. How important was that hole for Leylah Fernandez? All six of the players she has faced through this tournament have been current or former top 20 players. She has battled, she has fought, she has been a set down. She will fight to the end. But Laura, as you touched on, if the legs are going, she has played an awful lot of tennis over the course of the 2 weeks.
She really has, and the first few points of that game, it looks like, you know, it looked Thank like you. She wasn't getting enough knee bend behind the ball. She wasn't getting up to the short ones as quick as she was. But, you know, this is now a shootout to the end, and she'll find a way. She's such a battler.
Inside the baseline, backhand swung cross court from Raducanu, a short ball down the line from Fernandez. Fernandez with a forehand just swivels it and spins it cross court. Then she'll run around her backhand and she'll go inside out with a forehand. The forehand cross court from Raducanu, the backhand double hand cross court from Fernandez, who slaps the squash-shotted ball into the net, and it's 15 love.
Well, these concerns for Fernandez is where can she go in the rallies? And you'd say normally, normal conditions, you'd say, okay, go to Raducanu's forehand, which is can be a little hit and miss at times, but not this tournament. So where do you go? Where is she going to hit the ball to when she really needs under pressure?
Raducanu playing just her fourth senior level tournament at 15 love, plays a double-handed backhand, but nets. She crouched low, she swung into the ball, slammed it into the net.
I think Emma's actually making more errors on the backhand side at the moment, especially on the return like we've seen. But when Fernandez has that loopy lefty forehand and Emma tries to take it on the rise and hit the backhand that she likes, it's coming off with a different spin because Fernandez is a lefty. So it's a trickier shot to play.
Backhand cross court on the return for Fernandez, puts her in control at this point, but Raducanu gathers herself and settles for the backhand of the middle of the court, forehand through the middle. She tried to find the angle, Raducanu, but she netted in the firm left fist pump from Fernandez.
15-30.
In the middle again.
Fernandez on her toes, put back up to her box, face front once again. A really wide stance as she leans forward, Fernandez, as Raducanu winds herself up for the first serve at 15-30. First serve is very deep, it's slapped back on the forehand cross court. Now another forehand, the spin on the lefty forehand, double-handed backhand cross court and deep from Fernandez. Another double-handed, this time down the line, clips top of the net, turns into a drop shot. Here comes Raducanu, into the net she goes. The net coming to the rescue of Leylah Fernandez, who will take it at the moment, and she has break points.
Oh, that's tough to take. 15, Fernandez 14. Went for the flat down the line backhand and clipped the net, and Emma even got there pretty quickly, but just the surprise of the net cord was what turned it around. From love 40 on the Fernandez serve, here we are a game later with two break points the other way.
Raducanu not had to the bolter, so she will reset, and Fernandez, that wide stance, now on top of her toes. She hops, she slaps into the forehand, short ball. Raducanu comes in with a big, deep forehand. Too big and too deep for Fernandez.
30-40.
Respective boxes look tense. Crowd enjoying, having a great time. This is quality, quality tennis from both ends of the court. Another breakpoint opportunity for Leylah Fernandez, who has called this run magical. Raducanu with the serve. The serve is way wild and loose, and Fernandez just up on her toes again, saying, I'm fine, the legs are moving, I've got energy now into position, creeping a little bit closer to the baseline for the second serve. Now she takes a step back, swings into the forehand, but she nets.
Yes. Strange move. Going backwards.
Well, I thought because she went backwards, she was going to add height on the return.
Exactly.
That would be the normal shot to hit from way behind the baseline, not the flat one.
Give herself some time, do what the men do, to the Rafa version, to go back and loop it deep on a break point.
Great, heavy, penetrating serve down the tee from Raducanu.
Advantage, Raducanu.
Just touches the top of the orange visor that she's wearing, Raducanu, with her dark hair pulled up into a high plait that runs down between her shoulder blades. She leans forward, reaches up, slams the ball down, jumps off the top of the net and just swerves past Fernandez. Game point for Raducanu to come from 15-40 to hold serve for 2-1 in this second set, leading by a set to love. Raducanu serves. This time she steps in. Fernandez, the inside-in forehand from Raducanu. The backhand placed cross-court, a little bit shorter there. Took a little bit of length off the ball for Fernandez, and she drew the error.
Yes.
I feel like you can sense that Fernandez is trying to change something, trying to disrupt Emma's rhythm from the back of the court.
Juice.
Give her a different look at things.
Raducanu's just, the radar's gone off on the first serve momentarily. She takes a ball from the short she's wearing under the navy blue skirt with the red trim. She's got a red top, and now she serves down the tee. The off forehand is low and penetrating. Fernandez, who gets a short ball. She goes back behind Raducanu, and she gets breakpoint opportunity number three.
Fernandez.
Great footwork there on the return. Quick skip to the side, inside out forehand. That's where she's dangerous when she gets her feet in the right position. Nothing Emma could do about that. Just did well to get it back, in actual fact.
Break point, straight down the tee, back through the middle. Forehand Fernandez looking to go a break up. Into the net goes Emma Raducanu, and there's the break, and she shouts, come on, and she sometimes cries, Ale, as her box jumped to the feet. You can hear what the crowd on the Arthur Ashe Stadium think of that, because Leylah Fernandez has got the first break in this second set, and she leads with the break by 2-1. And Russell, you are so much closer to the atmosphere. I don't know if you managed to pop out at the end of that first set, but what a treat they are getting with this final.
I couldn't risk it, given the vagaries of the lift that we've all been experiencing for the last few years. You might be waiting 15 minutes to get back up again. So the thick plane of glass remains between me and the court, but I can see them, and they were on their feet as Leylah Fernandez got the break there. And it just goes to show, you can never write this extraordinary 19-year-old off. She looked like she'd been beaten on at least two occasions in this US Open, against Angelique Kerber and when Naomi Osaka was serving for a straight sets victory in the third round last Friday. But back she came. And this is going to be a really challenging period now, isn't it, for Emma Raducanu? Not just the break of serve down, but also with an increasingly excitable crowd in the Arthur Ashe Stadium, who are lending most of their support to the Canadian and who are very, very keen indeed to see a third set. And wouldn't we be too if we were neutrals, because the tennis has been of the absolute highest standard.
certainly has. Rowan has got in touch with us on social media. Camping, and the rules say no radios at any time. I can't believe that. But surely they can't mean Five Live Sport when Emma Raducanu is about to make history. Well, we don't care if that's what they deem.
We'll pay the fine.
We're doing it anyway. Yeah, I wonder if there's no radios at any time. Wow. Well, thank you for breaking that rule, Rowan. I'd like to get in touch with us at Five Live, at Five Live Sport.
Thank you, ladies.
Beautiful sight, the Arthur Ashe Stadium, packed full of fans. Leylah Fernandez, 19-year-old, world number 73 at the start of this tournament, with the break, serving down the tee, backhand through the middle of the court from Raducanu, who steps back. She's pushed back with the forehand, then trying to find the angle, but Fernandez slightly off balance, leaning into the backhand.
She got the shot that she wanted, though. Getting the ball down the middle is creating a few short balls for Fernandez. Nice juicy backhand down the line, but never hit it.
First serve into the net. Raducanu stepping up to the baseline to try and put some pressure on the Canadian. Gets ready to return serve. Fernandez reaching up into the skies and serves down the tee. The forehand is thundered back, and it's a service return winner.
Love 13.
Yeah, the second serve again. Raducanu all over it. And Fernandez, the placement of that one was right into the strike zone. It didn't have enough slice on the ball to dip into the body. Not a break until you hold.
Love 30, good wide serve, wide return. Just missing. You heard the cry from the electronic line calling. She can request a close call replay, but she knows that the call will not be changed. No line judges.
How close was that to another love 40? There was no way Fernandez was going to make that third ball.
15-30. Fernandez, the lefty, the 19-year-old, reaching up now. It's her second appearance at the US Open, lost in the second round last year to Sophia Kenin, former Australian Open winner. 15-30, second serve. Oh, look how close she was on that return, Raducanu. But she has to run back, and then she drops a short ball for the backhand cross court winner from Fernandez.
30-all.
Did everything right there, Raducanu. As you said, way inside the baseline.
Fernandez's box must be getting an absolute leg workout here. They are on their feet after every point.
Fitness trainer's kind of orchestrating them, isn't he? When he leaps, they leap. When he sits, they sit. 30-all, 2-1, looking to back up this break. Through the middle of the court they go. The forehand into the corner, cross court from Fernandez, who goes inside out with the forehand. The stretch on the lob from Raducanu. The ball will land back edge of the baseline. A high forehand up the line from Fernandez. Cross court goes Raducanu.
Made
a fist
it.
Pump because she made it, and she has a break back point.
Oh, my word. How did that ball drop in? Fernandez couldn't believe it. She let it bounce, thinking it was going way behind the baseline.
What a defensive shot from Raducanu. Was miles out of court, it hitting the forehand, and then dropped it onto the baseline. Fernandez dropped this fractionally short, and Raducanu is up really, really early. A little bit of miss hit, but she'll take that for the winner.
Missed first serve. Break back point. Raducanu up on the baseline saying, come on then, I'm here, I'm ready. Anything short, I will deal with it. Feet on the baseline, inside the baseline. Plays a double-handed backhand cross court winner. Break back, 2-all.
Go on, Emma. That's the backhand return that she was looking for in the last game when she was love 40.
Second serve.
As you said, Laura, those serves, second serves, she's not exactly sure what to do with them at the moment. She's tried to slide that one into the body again, but didn't quite hit the mark, and it just went straight onto the racket.
Just joining us here on Five Live, this is the US Open Women's Final. Emma Raducanu took the first set in 58 minutes, 6-4. She's just broken back for 2-all in the second, playing just her fourth senior-level tournament, her debut at the US Open. Yet to drop a set. 19 straight sets of tennis. As she serves down the tee, the off forehand return is very deep from Fernandez. Fernandez then goes back to the forehand that goes cross court from Raducanu. Inside in goes Fernandez. Backhand just drops off the racket from Raducanu into the net.
It feels like that's the play. You know, I think Fernandez just has to keep going for that one. Heavy through the middle. If she can jam Emma up on the backhand side, it seems like she's getting their most joy out of that. But it's difficult. I don't think that's her natural game style. I think she likes to play like a lefty and use the width of the court.
Forehand up the line. Raducanu is being so aggressive. She's so far up the court. The high ball, the lob is long. So much pressure that Raducanu is putting on Fernandez.
She's serving just that little bit better. I think that's probably the difference of the two players at the moment. Raducanu's second serve is, I said, is a better second serve.
26, 1:22 on the match clock. Floated ball back. Here comes Raducanu in a flash. She goes down the line. She couldn't get to it in time, Fernandez, to get the height on the ball that she was looking for.
How good's that pick up from Emma? It was a really tricky shot. Fernandez just got a racket on the return and it bounced way shorter than Raducanu expected.
Easy shot to miss that one, isn't it?
Very
running
easy.
Forward, running sidewards and short, and you've got to get top spin, get the ball over the net. She didn't do too much with it, just hit it deep and accurately.
Good serve down the tee. Raducanu plays the forehand deep to the forehand. Cross court with spin on it from Fernandez. Fernandez goes big forehand down the line. Squash shot, cross court will go wide from Raducanu. Just ratcheting up the intensity in that point, Fernandez.
30 all.
Just high enough for Fernandez to lay into that one and be able to hit the ball down with some pace. Decided to go down the line like Raducanu has been doing in the first set.
30 all. Serve out. Wow, it was a good serve. She was trying to step in and up on that Fernandez.
Again, Emma moving herself really wide to hit that first serve. She's leaving that down the line shot open, but it's the hardest return to hit for Fernandez. She's got to take the ball on the rise and cut through the slice that Emma's giving her on the first serve.
Game point. Serve down the tee, on the line, plumb on the line, as she will turn to her box. Her coach Andrew Richardson will return the raised, firm fist pump because she has held serve. It is 3-2 in this second set. And David Law, what a performance to this point from both. And as Pat said, probably the difference between the two at the moment is the quality of that first serve.
Yeah, and Pat knows what he's looking at better than me in terms of the shots that they're executing. I feel like just having covered it throughout the fortnight, basically we're seeing the two players that we've seen all fortnight coming head to head on the same court at the same time. And it's wonderful to witness. What I've really enjoyed about the way Raducanu's got to this position is how hard she has been pushed, and she has shown another side to herself today. We've seen the glorious ball striking and the overwhelming of opponents. Well, this is a totally different story. She's still playing pretty much as well, but she's just facing an opponent who's not rattled, who's not capitulating in the face of it. And if she wins this, Raducanu, she's going to be doing it the hard way, even if it is in straight sets.
Incredible stuff from these two young ladies, so inexperienced at this level, yet out here battling toe-to-toe, and as David said, bringing their A game, bringing the game that has got Leylah Fernandez through Naomi Osaka, Angelique Kerber, Lina Svitolina, and the world number two, Rina Sabalenka, and Raducanu through qualifying. All those weeks ago, she came for qualifying, she booked her flights home for the end of qualifying, and here she is, a set away from being a Grand Slam champion at the age of 18. Leylah Fernandez kicks legs up and down, keeping them loose. Hour and 25, needs to find the serve. 2-3 on serve. Gets it into the center of the box. Forehand plays through the middle. The forehand is swung cross court. That's a good, heavy, flat, lefty cross court forehand.
15 love.
Good serve into the body, making sure she made the first serve. She's very concerned about hitting a second serve now. And she can't serve at 100%, so Raducanu is going to get the opportunities to swing at a second serve sooner or later.
Sooner rather than later. As Raducanu steps up to the baseline, see if she can exert a little bit more pressure. And Fernandez is already feeling under the second serve. The second serve goes down the tee, the off forehand return, the forehand spins cross court from Fernandez down the line. Oh, she gets it. How did she find a slither of the baseline, Raducanu?
15-0.
That's going to be the hardest backhand she hit the whole day. That was absolute bullet.
Seventh backhand winner from Raducanu. I will say that Fernandez has lifted the first serve percentage slightly It was 50% in set one, now at 69%, so she's trying.
15-all, the off forehand drops a little bit short. Big, huge, heavy forehand winner down the line from Raducanu.
15-30.
I'm starting to get that feeling where you feel like you need to pace around the room a little bit, and I can't stop moving. This is, it feels like something's happening here.
15-30, Fernandez with the serve deep into the body, but she gets it back, Raducanu. It swings cross court and it misses, and it break points, Raducanu.
15-40.
Here we go. She takes a couple of seconds. They have 25 seconds on the shot clock, the serve clock, to get the first serve away. Opportunities, though, for Emma Raducanu to go a break up and then be two holds of serve away from being the US Open champion. 15-40. Listening to 5 Live. Oh. Serve misses, clips the top of the net, going out wide into the tram line. Second serve. Fernandez on her toes, keeping herself loose. Raducanu stepping up to the baseline to put some pressure on the second serve. 15-40, serve down the tee, the backhand is swung. Doesn't clip the sideline as she hoped it would, and the first break point is gone.
30-40.
That felt like that was going to drop in, the way that Emma's playing at the moment with so much freedom. She's hitting clean winners at the back of the line. Has just got that much more weight of shot than Fernandez.
Fernandez 30-40, wants the first serve, gets the first serve. It's a short ball. She steps forward with the forehand, the off forehand. She's buzzed! What a beauty from Raducanu! Fernandez stranded at the net. Raducanu passes the Canadian. She gets the break and she leads 4-2.
Well, the composure that we saw from Fernandez earlier on, where she waited for Raducanu to pick a side, wasn't there. She went way too early. Emma closed down that ball. Easy passing shot, and she's two games away.
She's the first qualifier to reach a Grand Slam final. She's the youngest British Grand Slam finalist for 62 years. And she's the first Grand Slam woman to reach a Grand Slam final in 44 years. It's incredible stuff from Emma Raducanu, who's two holds of serve away. She serves out wide, and it's an ace. 15-love, 4-2, a setup.
And that first point under the belt, first point of the game, is so important. Fernandez cannot afford to make a mistake now.
What happened with the ball toss, Raducanu? Serves now down the tee. The backhand swings through the middle of the court. Raducanu looks in control, doesn't she? Looks so smooth. She gets the backhand. In comes Fernandez. Goes back behind Raducanu. Little fist bump. Good body language still from Leylah Fernandez.
You actually can't fault Fernandez's attitude throughout this whole tournament. She's been here before. She's been a set and 4-2 down against Kerber earlier on in the tournament, and she just never gives in. She finds that extra bit of energy.
15-all, Raducanu reaching up and serving, an hour and a half on the clock, the back and into the centre of the court. Swung through the middle goes Raducanu. Forehand inside in from Fernandez, who plays a double-handed backhand cross court and wide.
She hasn't missed many of those, has she? Backhand cross court.
30-15.
Yeah, that was her opportunity to push Raducanu out of position. Didn't quite get hold of the ball properly. The pace again down the line, backhand.
30-15, 4-2. Raducanu serves out wide, a heavy forehand, middle of the court, cross court on the angle, goes Raducanu into the net, goes Fernandez, and it's game point for 5-2 for Emma Raducanu.
40-15.
Yeah, and she's hitting a bigger ball. She's hitting a cleaner strike. She's getting ahead earlier on in the rally, getting the first strike in off
Thank
the third
you.
Ball.
A point for 5-2. The final of the US Open, leading Leylah Fernandez by a set to love, and the break at 4-2. She winds herself up, Raducanu serves down the tee and misses, discards that ball. She won't be using it again, takes a ball from the shorts under the skirt on the left-hand side. Settles herself, rocks forward, rocks back, reaches up, tosses the ball, not happy. Settles, resets, wide stance, prowling, leaning forward. Fernandez on her toes, swings into the backhand, pushes it long, and there's the point, and there is the game. And Emma Raducanu is a game away from being the US Open champion. Stunning stuff from the 18-year-old Russell. It is unbelievable we are in this position at this stage, and she is a game away.
And by one
she has been the better player, hasn't she, in an outstanding match. There's not much in it, and Leylah Fernandez has come from behind so many times before this last fortnight. I am not going to write her out of this match yet, but you can't help but think this is such a golden opportunity now for Emma Raducanu. I've just had the binoculars out looking at Virginia Wade, who is courtside, the champion here in 1968. She looks as tense as you would expect her to. Virginia Wade, Sue Barker and Ann Jones, the only British female Grand Slam singles champions of the Open era, which already goes back over half a century. She's not looked fazed by the pressure at all. I think it's time to bring this change of ends to a close. Block out from your mind, Emma, any thoughts about being one game away from winning a Grand Slam title, and just get the job done.
All the pressure in the world now on Leylah Fernandez. Emma Raducanu is sort of cuddling the air conditioning unit. It's under her chin and the air is blowing up, keeping herself cool, trying to keep the mind clear. And she is the first player off their seat and to the back of the court. She skips and now runs to the back of the court. She can have a swing at this because she's 5-2 up in the second set. Leylah Fernandez serving to stay in the US Open final.
I do feel like it's easier to come out and break for the match, especially with the way that Emma's been returning the second serves. She can swing so freely here. Get the first strike in.
Thank you. Ready for play.
The crowd settles. Raducanu takes a deep breath. Fernandez with the ball, looks across, looks down, gets into her serve routine. Reaches up with the first serve, gets it down the tee, the off backhand deep, and the backhand battered back by Fernandez, who opens up the forehand and goes cross court, and it's long. And Raducanu is 3 points from the title.
I don't know how she's so calm. Nothing phases Emma Raducanu.
2-5, love 15. Fernandez not happy with the bounce, settles, restarts, sets, reaches and serves into the net. Quickly the ball comes from the shorts under the skirt, bouncing up and down on her toes as Raducanu steps in and up to the baseline, makes her presence felt. 3 points from the win. Second serve, she's inside the baseline. She slams the double-handed backhand through the middle of the court. The backhand is swung cross-court. The stretch forehand cross-court from Raducanu. It's defended back, but it's short. Backhand up the line from Raducanu, who plays the forehand now, going cross-court and just wide.
A good second serve, wasn't it, that one? Nothing. She has to come up with some good second serves. That one was fast, it was in the body. Had a bit of slice to it. Just enough. Just close enough to her body, Raducanu's body, that she couldn't take a proper swing at it.
15 on serve out wide. Forehand netted.
30-15.
We want to ask that question of Emma Raducanu. Can you serve for it? Can you take this on your racket? Raducanu is thinking, I want to get it done here, but it's 30-15, 2-5. Fernandez with the serve out wide, backhand cross court, redirected forehand down the line and deep, pushes back, gets a short ball, inside out forehand from the Canadian, who gets a high ball. She will let it bounce. It clips the back edge of the court. Here comes Raducanu, forehand up the line. The lob is up from Fernandez. The overhead is soft from Raducanu. The forehand is netted from Fernandez.
Bit of a laugh from Raducanu because she mishit the smash, but it was enough, and it was short enough that Fernandez couldn't quite get her feet there. But how good has Raducanu's returning been when she's pushed so wide? Just gets a racket on the ball, flings it up in the air, and somehow it lands right on the baseline.
Thank you.
Everything is falling into place.
2 points from being the US Open champion. Fernandez serves down the tee, she misses. Long down the center line. In comes Raducanu, bouncing on her toes, Fernandez. Will it be a game point or a championship point? Fernandez with the second serve goes out wide. The forehand is slammed back. She's being really aggressive. Raducanu into the net goes Fernandez. And it is championship point for Emma Raducanu. The qualifier, who has not dropped a set, the 18-year-old in her second Grand Slam appearance, is a point away from being the US Open champion. This is the stuff of dreams. Championship point, Raducanu. 30-40.
The serve from Fernandez goes down the tee. The stretch, it's a mid-court ball. The forehand slapped into the corner. Too good. And the championship point is saved.
Yes. Serve committed to getting after the forehand.
Everybody takes a deep breath, including the players. Deuce, 2-5. Raducanu waits. Fernandez serves and snaps it into the net. Ball boy collects, gets back into his position. Raducanu will step forward. Hour and 37 on the match clock. Deuce, championship point has been saved. The second serve goes down the tee. The backhand through the middle of the court. The forehand cross court, very deep from Fernandez, who then has to redirect the forehand up the line. The forehand down the line from Raducanu. Snap cross court and the forehand from Fernandez. Into the net from Raducanu, and it's game point.
She's got a smile on her face, Fernandez. She's really enjoying this.
Fernandez.
Not sure how she can, to be honest. But three very good points in a row.
Game point to ask the question of her 18-year-old opponent. 2-5. First serve, gets it, backhand cross court. She cannot handle the strength and the weight of shot off the returner. Serve Juice. The Canadian, and it's Juice.
And we've seen it time and time again when these last few games of the match get close, is when Raducanu's just relentless. She wants to win in this opportunity. She's had one match point already, but she's just committed to getting after it.
Five Live Tennis from Flushing Meadows in New York. Deuce, serve into the body, the off back and loops up, sits up, the off forehand, drop short from Fernandez, who scampers the forehand side. It will not find the court, and it will be championship point number two.
Advantage, Raducanu.
Everyone settles. Championship point number two for the 18-year-old qualifier from Great Britain. Fernandez with the serve down the tee. The forehand, the off forehand sits up at an awkward shot, but it's short, and it's into the net from Raducanu on the inside out forehand, and it's Juice.
He went for it.
Juice.
1 inch. It was a winner.
That's such a positive sign that she's going for it, though.
Thank you.
Tim Henman can't breathe on the side of the court.
Juice. Leylah Fernandez in position. The 19-year-old from Canada has been on one long journey to get to this spot right now. Second serve. She bounces, she settles. Ball against the throat of the racket before she reaches up and serves down the tee. And the backhand through the middle of the court from Raducanu. They're playing through the middle, no angles for either at the moment. Backhand cross court from Fernandez. The forehand up the line and good and short from Raducanu, who gets a short ball, goes inside out with the forehand. Forehand down the line from Fernandez is good. It is too good for the outstretching Raducanu and his game point.
Oh, what a forehand. Emma had the short ball. She decided Fernandez to go inside out. Fernandez, I've got to say, had a bit of a guess there. Ran straight onto it, hit it perfectly. Foot inside the baseline.
Game point. Will she get a first serve? Yes, she does. It thunders back. It's a cricket shot from the back of the court from Fernandez. Now plays a double-handed backhand cross-court. The forehand cross-court. The double-handed down the line from Fernandez. The stretch backhand cross-court from Raducanu. Forehand whip cross-court. That was vicious from Fernandez. And she saves two championship points. She holds serve, and she will ask the question of Emma Raducanu. Can you serve it out to be US Open champion?
My word, Fernandez is having to work hard for it, though.
Raducanu leads 5-3, second set.
It's a relentless hitting from Raducanu, and I don't get the sense that she's nervous, you know. She had two championship points in that game. She kept going for her shots. Fernandez lifted her level a little bit, and
thank you,
I really feel like Emma Raducanu is going to come out and serve for the US Open here.
The flip side is she's got another chance to break as well to the way she's been returning.
God,
so she might as well go for a shot, go for a serve.
Thank you.
Go for the big wide serve. It's been very effective.
Serving.
On this first side.
For the US Open title, Emma Raducanu, not had through the ball toss, resets. Back into position, Fernandez. Not happy with the ball toss again. Back into position goes Fernandez. Maybe a sign of
how she's feeling. The biggest moment of her very young career. Serves out wide. That's a wonderful serve. It's blocked back on the backhand side, but it finds the court. The forehand goes centre of the court, and Fernandez switches the forehand and goes cross court. The backhand flattened out, cross court. The forehand win it down the line from the Canadian for love 15.
Love 15.
Well, Emma's got to go for the favourite serve down the tee here, under pressure. That's her go-to serve. Does Fernandez know that? She should.
5-3, love 15. Raducanu reaches up and serves down the tee. Backhand through the middle of the court. The backhand from Raducanu is cross-court and deep. Another backhand from Raducanu is cross-court. A little bit short in the service line. Forehand clips off the net down the line from Fernandez, who runs around, goes, oh, forehand, but she misses. Wasn't quite, didn't have the feet quite right. Misses, goes wide, 15-all. Oh, there are a lot of nerves in this crowd on the court. 5-3, Emma Raducanu serving to be the US Open champion. She serves out wide, she stretches her opponent, she's opened up the down line, she goes down line, it's too good!
Absolutely huge, 15-all serving for the title. You stick with what has got you to this position. Wide serve, the combination with the forehand down the line, it's worked almost every single time, but that is so clutch to have the mental strength to go for that one in this situation.
5-3, 30-15. Raducanu with the first serve goes down the tee. The stretch to the backhand through the middle of the court. It's a short ball. It's backhand up the line. She's at the net. Raducanu, she plays the half volley. It's up for Fernandez to go cross court. And it's a winner for the Canadian because it's into the net from the Brit. And it's 30-all.
Well, she was stranded at the net there. Raducanu, good passing shot, really low. But she guessed. You know, she had stretched her arm out and had a bit of a guess, and gee, tell you what, she almost dribbled that over the net.
Do we get a championship point or a breakback point? First serve goes out wide, the backhand stretches open up the down line, she goes back behind, the backhand is there, cross court from Fernandez, the forehand on the stretch, cross court from Raducanu, down the line goes Fernandez, pick up, she's on the floor, Raducanu, inside out forehand, great recovery from Raducanu, the point will continue, the ball will land long, and it is breakback point. Wow! Took a bit of a tumble there, Emma Raducanu, when she was stretching out wide.
That's about as brave as you can get from Fernandez.
That was a perfect point from Fernandez.
You almost would have said it was stupid, some of the couple of shots that she went for.
She's bleeding from the fall on her leg, Emma Raducanu. She's just got a cut just under the left knee. So I think they're going to need to clean up.
Play has to stop. I don't think you can play if you... Oh, she really slid on that leg on the replay. That
hurts. See the skin she left on the ground.
But they won't be able to play if she is bleeding, so the physio will have to come on court quickly. Oh, what a moment for this to happen.
Can you believe there is a break back point opportunity? And Leylah Fernandez, I don't know whether it's nerves or she's genuinely that happy out there right now, but she cannot stop smiling and laughing, Pat Cash.
It's incredible, isn't it? It's the freedom of youth. This is kind of fun out here. The crowd are roaring. I'm going to break that point. And the pickups, though, from Raducanu, as we're watching the replay, is sliding across. She skidded a good 4 feet on her knee there.
I sort of love that she wanted to continue play, though. Knew she was bleeding and was kind of like, yeah, I'm ready, though.
Both of these girls, aren't they? Unbelievable movers.
And Russell, and the bravery from both of these players out there. There is so much to play for. The noise from the crowd. I mean, it has everything, this final.
It's just been fabulous viewing and fabulous listening. The blood trickling down Emma Raducanu's left leg, almost into her shoe, which is why the physio has had to come on court. And it's harsh, isn't it? That counts as a medical timeout, which means that she wouldn't be able to have treatment again if that becomes a problem in future. Although if there was blood involved, then I think the physio would have to return. She looks very, very cool. A chance to take a drink, an energy gel. I don't think the pain will be an issue, because the adrenaline will probably block all of that out. The supervisor having a chat now with Leylah Fernandez. The music has struck up in the background. It's really, really unfortunate timing, but there's no alternative. There's nothing else that could be done other than for that knee to be attended to. I can't imagine it'll take much longer, but I mean, this is not great for either player, is it? Particularly for Fernandez, who had a breakback point to get back on serve in this second set.
Well, both players wanted to continue. I think Fernandez is saying that it's happened to her before where she's carried on playing, but you know, that was a fair bit of blood coming out of Emma's knee.
Yeah.
I don't think she would have been able to continue. You know, the rules are
maybe a Band-Aid quite specific. She'd be on her way.
They won't use the full 3 minutes of the medical.
Put a Band-Aid on and go out there. Ooh, she's grimacing. I think they put a bit of antibiotic cream or something on it.
Leylah Fernandez is still chatting away. I'm not sure it's the most sensible thing to do for her to be.
She's getting wound up, isn't she? She's really getting herself upset. She should be back there. And I mean, this is, she's getting herself quite angry at the fact that it's, the match has stopped. It absolutely had to.
And
the music goes on, and of course, Emma comes out there and serves a big serve. It's almost it's taking the momentum out of Fernandez a little bit, but it's the way it goes. She has to deal with this.
There's still a minute left of the medical timeout. We've seen a couple of pieces of dressing over what looks like a cotton wool pad, and they're just mopping up the bits and pieces around the bandages. The cheer is for Leylah Fernandez. She's taken a quick drink and she's back at her side of the court and her box applauding. Said, come in, come on, stay focused, you can do this. She's got a break point now. It's her eighth break point of the match. She's converted just two of the seven opportunities she's had. This to get us back on serve in the second set.
This game has been very, very strong throughout the tournament. Unbelievable. Strong in actual fact. He's coming up with big serves on break points.
30-40.
Break point, Leylah Fernandez.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Ready for play. Thank you.
5-3, serving for the title, 30-40. Raducanu not happy with the ball toss, just tossed it too far in front of her, so she lets it drop. Up she goes again the second time. She gets serve into the body, the off backhand return. Drops really short, didn't mean that, Fernandez. Then she plays the forehand cross court. This is break back point. Deep ball off the backhand from Raducanu, who plays the off forehand. The forehand spins long and loose and wild from the Canadian, and it's juice.
Juice.
That's when you don't get angry at the situation. Remain calm. She's still got a bit of a smirk on that smile on her face, but the miss hits in that point. Certainly lost the momentum.
Raducanu serving for the title. It's juice. She's 2 points away. She misses the first serve. Ball boy scurries across to collect. Second serve. 5-3 in juice. Coming up to an hour and 50 on the match clock. The second serve. That's a really good second serve. It's opened up the down the line. She goes down the line. Fernandez goes. She puts the lob up. High, high ball. Raducanu lets it drop. It sort of swerves in midair. She plays a lofted ball. A forehand through the middle of the court. This is for breakback point or championship point number 3. Steps in forehand cross court. Raducanu on the angle. Backhand cross court from Fernandez. Forehand long from Raducanu. And it's breakback point number 2 for Leylah Fernandez.
I've got to say, for the first time in the match, the situation is actually getting to them. And I'm surprised, but
Fernandez.
Timid point from both of them. Poor point, the point before from Fernandez.
Thank you.
To get us back on serve in this second set. Raducanu winds herself up, serves down the tee. Backhand goes down the line, forehand up the line. Squash shot from Fernandez. Short ball for Raducanu, goes back to Fernandez, but it's not high enough on the lob. Raducanu reaches up, finds a slice of the racket on the ball and saves the break point.
you're hot.
The hardest possible smash for Raducanu to hit. It was too high over the shoulder. She couldn't even get a full swing on it.
Sticks a racket out there and it dribbles over the net for a winner.
Juice.
Great athleticism.
5-3. Serve down the tee. blocked back mid-court ball, backhand into the corner. The stretch on the backhand from Fernandez. High ball, long ball, championship point number three.
Advantage, Raducanu.
18-year-old qualifier. A point to become the US Open champion. Championship point number three. Serve out. What is an ace? She's done it with an ace. She's down on the floor. Emma Raducanu is the US Open champion at the age of 18. She came through qualifying. She has not dropped a set. 20 straight sets of tennis. She cannot believe it, but believe it she must. The fairy tale in New York. Emma Raducanu is the US Open champion with a straight set 6-4, 6-3 win.
Word. What a performance from Emma Raducanu. So clutch under pressure. She's just a phenomenal talent. But, you know, to deliver that sort of performance today, I think is another level. She is an absolute champion. She's won the US Open at the age of 18, the first qualifier ever to even make it to the final. And she's won the tournament with the tennis that got her there under pressure. She was unbelievable tonight, and I think it's just the full package. Her movement's fantastic, her shots are incredible, the pace, the way that she takes the ball on the rise. But for me, mentally today, she was outstanding.
And now she's trying to find a way, Russell, to get to her box. She was trying to leap up there, it's too high, trying to find a chair, couldn't. So now she's going the civilized route through the corridor, up the stairs, and then she will turn up in her box.
Yeah, you don't practice for this, do you? When you turn up at your second Grand Slam and you've got three rounds of qualifying to negotiate and you're knackered because you played five matches en route to the final in Chicago the week before. What have we just been watching inside the Ash Stadium? Leylah Fernandez still unhappy with that medical timeout, which Emma Raducanu had no alternative to take. Now, finally, she's re-emerged from the tunnel. There was no way through there either. She's gone underneath the metal barrier. You can hear the crowd a hooping and a hollering, slapping her on the back. She's going to make it through to those in the players' box. And it's going to be a very emotional moment. Her parents couldn't be here. Ian and Renee will be watching back home. Travel restrictions make it difficult to schedule a trip to watch your 18-year-old daughter win a Grand Slam at short notice. She's being led by two blue-shirted security guards. It's a very circuitous route. She's almost done a complete tour of the Arthur Ashe Stadium. She'll be there shortly, and she's made it. And the first hug goes for Andrew Richardson, her coach. Now for her agent, Chris Hellier. The LTA physio, Will Herbert, there as well. Ian Bates of the LTA, the head of women's tennis, also there, and it's celebrations all round. Emma Raducanu, wiping a tear or two away from her eye, and now she'll have to make her way back exactly the way she came. There's no leaping from that sort of height onto this hard court here in New York. She's being very, very well protected by those security guards. They look like they are on a mission. No one is going to get too close to the US Open champion. Oh no, they've gone the wrong way. There's no way through down there. There is a second route back to the court, the lap of honour. And I think she's going to get a huge roar when she finally makes it back onto terra firma in just a moment. The security guard just moving a over-enthusiastic fan out of the way. And here comes Emma Raducanu. Very close to the court again. She needs to make her way through the photographers. She'll go past Tim Hemman, who's down there working for television, who came so close himself to reaching a Grand Slam final. Leylah Fernandez, we now see in tears on her chair. And you really have to feel for her, because she beat Naomi Osaka, she beat Angelique Kerber, she beat another couple of top five players. She did things that seemed utterly implausible for somebody who started the tournament at 18 and is a world number 73. But sport is a ruthless business. There could only be one winner. And as we just watched the replay on the big screen, that winner is Emma Raducanu. She is a US Open champion, a Grand Slam champion.
20 straight sets of tennis, starting at the very beginning of qualifying. That is absolutely incredible. The last person to win the US Open without dropping a set was Serena Williams. It's phenomenal what she has done in these now 3 weeks. She will be the world number 23 on Monday when the new rankings come out. She takes a check for $2.5 million. It's unbelievable, this journey that she started. She said she has been most impressed with her mental strength, and I think everybody has been. I mean, you mentioned it in comments, she's been clutch through this whole tournament. Everything she's faced, she has turned it around to a positive, and she has come through, and it couldn't have been much cleaner than these 2 weeks.
Absolutely. You know, we kept saying before the match that Fernandez had had the practice in those pressure situations because she'd been in the three sets deep in the third, had won 7-6 in the third, but you know, it was close tonight and it didn't really matter because Emma delivered the tennis that got her to the final, where she was playing so aggressive, able to see what was happening over the other side of the net. I think read the game fantastic tonight and found a way to dig deep and win, and to do it with an ace. You couldn't close out a tournament any better than that. I think she's just going to get better and better. She's going to grow physically. You know, she can get so much stronger still as she gets older. But how is it possible that we're watching this happen over the last 3 weeks with someone who was 150 in the world 3 weeks ago and will now be seeded at the Australian Open, even if she doesn't play for the rest of the year?
Pat, 3 months ago, she had never played a tour level match, and here we are now celebrating her as the US Open champion.
I just can't believe it. I honestly cannot believe it. I've been shaking my head for the last week. But it's just unheard of for a qualifier to come through and win the US Open. I mean, it's just absolutely unheard of. Okay, we've seen Goran Ivanisevic come as a wild card, but he'd already been to three Wimbledon finals or two Wimbledon finals, not playing in the second ever Grand Slam. I mean, it's absolutely phenomenal. And, you know, she's just hits the ball so cleanly. She feels so incredibly confident. But it's, I cannot come up with a reason for this to happen. It does not make sense at all. but she's done it. It's just absolutely mind-boggling, her performance over the last, these 3 weeks, but particularly over the last couple of months since she's been on the circuit.
And she's done it, Laura, by playing flawless tennis. I mean, it's also the standard of the tennis that she has produced match after match.
It really has been phenomenal. And I thought she played well at Wimbledon. She did amazing to reach the fourth round there. But the growth that we've seen from her as a player since then has been what's impressed me the most, where she made the final of Chicago a couple of weeks after Wimbledon. It was a smaller WTA tournament. And from then on, through the US Open, through qualifying, through the first couple of rounds, she got better and better and better. And we kept saying, oh, surely these players are going to be nervous before the final and we hope it's a good match. They both absolutely delivered today. That's the highest level of women's tennis that I've seen in a final in quite some time from both players.
And we're going to have a proposal, aren't we? Because remember... Remember, Craig said...
I was going to say, did Craig really want her to win or not want her to win? That's the thing.
Craig said that after Wimbledon, when she wins a Grand Slam, he would propose to his boyfriend. He probably didn't think it was going to be at the next Grand Slam, but it's happened. So congratulations, Craig.
Surely we've got to listen to the chorus here. The crowd are going nuts for Emma singing.
She's giving it a little bit of a sing as she sits there.
Unofficial British anthem.
She cannot believe it as they get set for the presentation. Billie Jean King walking behind her.
And she's not the only one who can't believe it. The whole tennis world can't believe it. I mean, I thought there was only one thing that could possibly knock if Novak Djokovic wins the
Please welcome the participants
Grand Slams
for tonight's
of the year,
women's singles championship
would be the greatest surprise of all time. And then this is
Tournament
it right
director,
here.
Stacey Allister.
But of course, big match tomorrow. Novak's got to get there.
Executive director Michael Dowse. USTA chairman of the board and president Mike McNulty.
Representing JP Morgan Chase, Andrea
Stadium Lisha. Andy, who is the announcer here in the Arthur Ashe Stadium, just explaining who is going to be on the stage and very shortly handing over that US Open trophy to Emma Raducanu.
And our host from ESPN, Mary Jo Fernandez.
The stage is ready, blue and yellow. The players are ready, Leylah Fernandez and the US Open champion, Emma Raducanu.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about another round of applause for a terrific final and for Emma and Leylah. Please welcome, carrying the finalists and champion trophies, future American tennis champions, 12-year-old Isabella De Lucia from the Garden State Tennis Center, West Orange Tennis Club, and 12-year-old Matteo Puso from the Falls Club of the Palm Beaches.
Here they come, onto the stage, and very carefully putting those trophies in place.
To begin the trophy ceremony, we'd like to recognize our tournament referee, Wayne McEwen, and the chair umpire for today's final, Mariana Veljović.
And it's Mariana Veljović from Serbia who walks forward and receives.
It is now my pleasure to introduce the chairman of the board and president of the USTA, Mike Minolti.
Thank you, Mary Jo. We began our Open Women's Final with a solemn tribute to those whose lives we lost 20 years ago. And tonight, we end with a celebration. Over the past 3 weeks, we've witnessed an amazing display of talent by the future of our sport, led by the two of you. Not since 1999 have two teenagers competed for the U.S. Open singles trophy. Emma, Leylah, your poise and your persistence, your grit, your determination, and your smiles have become role models and an inspiration. And what has made this U.S. Open particularly gratifying, it is having you, the greatest fans in the world, back in New York. On behalf of the USTA, our 17 sections, our thousands of amazing volunteers, thank you all for making the 2021 US Open the greatest return.
Thank you, Mike. And now let's hear from our finalist, Leylah Fernandez.
Just remember, she beat the defending champion, Naomi Osaka, 2016 champion, Angelique Kerber, two other top five players, won her last four matches in three sets, but couldn't get past Emma Raducanu in this final. She's made a huge name for herself, not just here, but all around the world.
Leylah.
And she's laughing and smiling, tear-stained eyes.
It was an incredible tournament. I know you're disappointed, but what do you think of everything that you've accomplished these last 2 weeks?
It's incredible. I honestly have no idea what to say. Today is going to be hard to recuperate, but Emma played amazing, so congratulate Emma and to your team. But you know what? I'm very proud of myself with the way I played these past 2 weeks, and especially having the crowd back. The New York crowd has been amazing, and it's definitely special for me to be here in the finals and having you cheering me on. Thank you so much, New York. Thank you, everyone.
Well done, Leylah.
You don't get here alone. What message do you have for your family? Your mom's here, your sisters are here, your dad's watching on TV. What message do you have for them and their support?
Thank you for always believing me. You guys are amazing. You were there with when I was in my lows, when I was suffering, when I was having a tough time, and you were also there when I was having the best of times. So thank you for always having my back. Thank you for always believing in me, and thank you for helping me. And I also want to say that I hope to be back here in the finals, and this time with a trophy. With the right one, with the right trophy.
All right, well, on behalf of the USTA, Mike McNulty will present you with your trophy.
Can I just say one more thing?
Oh, one more thing.
I know this. On this day, it was especially hard for New York and everyone around the United States. I just want to say that I hope I can be as strong and as resilient as New York has been the past 20 years.
Very, very classy indeed.
Thank you for always having my back. Thank you for cheering for me. I love you, New York, and hope to see you next year.
Leylah Fernandez receives her runner-up trophy and shows it to the crowd. Now, does anybody want to hear from a British Grand Slam singles champion?
And now it's time for our champion, Emma Raducanu. You started this journey 3 weeks ago. You're the first qualifier to ever win a major tournament. How did you do it?
First of all, I really want to congratulate Leylah and her team on an incredible fortnight. I mean, she's played some incredible tennis and beaten some of the top players in the world, so it was an incredibly difficult match, but I thought the level was extremely high, and I hope that we play each other in many more tournaments and hopefully finals. As for the 3 weeks I've spent in New York, I would say that having such a supportive team like I have over there, my coach, Will, the physio, the LTA, my agent, everyone in that team, and everyone back home who isn't here but watching on TV, thank you so much for all your support over the years. And most of all, I would say thank you to everyone here, New York. Thank you all for making me feel so at home from my first qualifying match all the way to the final. I've loved playing in front of you, and you've really spurred me on in some very difficult moments. And I hope that me and Leylah put on a good performance today.
You both certainly did. You played 10 matches. You didn't drop a set. A little bit of adversity towards the end of the match. You had match points. Leylah holds her serve. And then you had to face a few break points. How did you hold on to that composure?
Yeah, of course, Leylah's always going to play great tennis and always going to fight. That's just the competitor she is, and that's why she's here in the finals. So I knew that I'd have to dig deep, and I fell somehow, and I thought that would throw myself off balance, really, because I was going to have to serve. I was just praying not for a double fault, but we got through it, and I think just staying in the moment, focusing on what I had to do, and my process and the mindset just really helped in those tough times.
Emma, this is the youngest final we've had since 1999. What does this say about the future of women's tennis?
I think it shows that the future of women's tennis and just the depth of the game right now is so great. I think every single player in the women's draw definitely has a shot of winning any tournament. So I hope that the next generation can follow in the steps of some of the greatest legends, for example, Billie Jean right here, and everyone that's at the top of the game right now.
And finally, speaking of another legend, Virginia Wade has been watching all your matches. She's here to witness. She's the last one to win a major from Great Britain. What does that mean to you?
It means so much to have Virginia here and also Tim, to have such British legends and icons for me to follow in their footsteps. It really helps, and it definitely gave me the belief that I could actually do it.
Congratulations, Emma. And now to hand you the prize money check. Are you ready for how much? $2.5 million is Andrea Lischer, head of America's client JP Morgan Asset Management.
She can not expect any pocket money, Dad, in future.
And now, Emma, the great Billie Jean King will present you with your champion trophy.
The Silver Cup, which has been in the hands of Billie Jean King before and is again now, but only temporarily as she hands on to the next generation. Emma Raducanu studying the names
Ladies
on that trophy.
Your 2021 US Open Women's Champion, Emma Raducanu.
The qualifier, the 18-year-old, just holding the trophy by her side as the ticker tape explodes on the Arthur Ashe court. Red, white, blue, silver. In only her second Grand Slam, Emma Raducanu becomes the fastest player ever to win a slam. And by that I mean nobody has ever won a Grand Slam title at fewer than three attempts before. She's done it as a qualifier. She is the first British female Grand Slam champion for 44 years. I've never seen anything like it, and I suspect that if I keep working in this business for another 20 years, I will never see anything like this again.
It's unbelievable, isn't it, Russ? We're just seeing the shot of Stacey Alistair, the tournament director, Billie Jean King, and Leylah Fernandez, and Emma Raducanu, and just listening to them, Pat Cash, they're up there. It's only a fourth senior tournament for Emma Raducanu, and Leylah Fernandez has been around a little bit longer, and there they are standing in the middle of Arthur Ashe, giving speeches to this crowd of 24,000 people.
Yeah, look, I think you're right. I've been watching this game for a long time and hopefully a lot longer, but yeah, this is something that I never could have believed in a million years would happen. And but it's interesting that what Emma said is that every girl believes they can get out there and win the tournament. And we've seen that this year at the French Open. Krejcikova said that. She won back, you know, singles and the doubles, coming from 50 or so in the world. And she said that. She said, I've given confidence to everybody in the locker room because anybody can win this tournament, win a Grand Slam. And but from qualifying, I mean, come on. And without dropping a set, I sometimes think that I'm going to wake up. You know, it's just so unbelievable. I mean, I don't know. I've got to go back to school and come up with some better superlatives than this. But it is. It's just absolutely shocking and flabbergasting to see this performance over 2 weeks, two and a half weeks.
Yeah, and I think there's so many sliding doors moments in tennis. And before Wimbledon, Emma didn't even have a main draw wild card. And would we be seeing this had they not upgraded it to a main draw? and for everything to fall into place the way that it has done, would she even be in this position had the fourth round of Wimbledon not happened to her, where she had to retire due to breathing problems? I think the amount that she learnt from that experience over the course of the next few weeks is what's got her to this moment, where she's standing with the winner's trophy of the US Open. It's just amazing how it falls into place for a player. And, you know, they can come out, play their best tennis over 3 weeks, maybe the best tennis of their life, but I really feel like Emma's got way more to give, and she's just going to get better and better. She's already a phenomenal player. She played an almost perfect match tonight in her first ever Grand Slam final, and you have to think there's going to be so many more for her.
Yeah, I think you're right. The Wimbledon setback, and what a great story. I mean, I've always been a massive believer that, you know, these setbacks make you stronger. I mean, I've actually got it tattooed on my arm. You know, this too shall pass. That, you know, you get through these things, and you become stronger. You know, and so, you know, I think it's been, probably at the time, you would think that anything could happen. She could literally capitulate and say, I can't go out there and play tennis anymore. I get too tight. I mean, there's a great documentary on TV about Marty Fish now, which I watched a couple of nights ago. Was a classic story of a guy who just had panic attacks and could never really play again when he was in the top of his game. Got the number seven in the world. But it was the end of it almost. It was pretty much the end. So that can happen. It can absolutely ruin you. And for her to be turning around here and overcome that and learn, and as I said at the beginning, that the number one thing, technique and the ability to be able to learn and listen and learn is just so huge. And you know, she's done that just incredibly. And what a match today. I mean, Fernandez didn't, certainly, I think, you know, matches I saw, she was easily the best player that Emma played. And, you know, she really, you know, put it to her, and she just held strong.
Leylah Fernandez has now left the court, and Emma Raducanu is kissing the trophy. Firstly to the bank of photographers, and now she's walking around to the fans around the court, that big smile on her face as she raises it above her head, and there are more cheers. David Lord, do you have any more superlatives to add to this? I think we've all run out.
No, I have no more superlatives really to add to what you're saying, other than just the feelings that these two players have given me over the course of the 2 weeks, and the way they've delivered them again when it mattered on the biggest stage in the biggest night of their lives in the final. And that is that Fernandez kept on coming. She pushed Raducanu into areas that she hadn't been pushed throughout the fortnight, and yet Raducanu still won 6-4, 6-3. This young woman has otherworldly talent. To be able to play like that in her first ever Grand Slam final, in her second ever Grand Slam tournament, I just can't believe what I've seen. And I'm not sure I'll ever quite be able to believe it until she just starts doing it again. But maybe that will never happen. But on this particular day, wow, something else.
And the other thing is, as Laura so correctly said, that she's going to get better. I mean, she's barely put any pre-season or fitness training or any of that sort of stuff into her game. I mean, she's incredibly inexperienced, but yet can perform at this level. So, you know, their upside for her is enormous. I mean, she is, you know, even if she didn't win today, certainly they're going to be the hottest player, the superstar. I mean, we say Naomi Osaka would probably, you know, is a big, huge name. She's three-time slam. We don't know what's going to happen with that Naomi. Is she going to play or is she not going to play? This girl's going to be here. She's going to be one of the favourites of the Australian Open. She's going to be, you know, Rory, you know, one of the favourites for Wimbledon. So, you know, she's going to be an absolute megastar, and rightly so, the way she hits the ball and her composure, and the way that she can continue to improve.
And David, there's that word again, composure. We've used it so much over the course of 2 weeks, and she's now hugging Tim Henman on the court, but it's her composure on court, but it's also her composure off the court, because she's had to deal with all sorts of media issues, television, radio, press, absolutely everything, and she's handled it with such grace.
She's handled it as if it's fun, all of it, as though she's just having the time of her life, as though, why would this not be great to do? And that's just not something we're used to. It's her innocence in coming to it fresh, but just her general attitude is so refreshing, and it'll probably have an impact on everybody else that follows to some degree. But yeah, you're right. And actually, I thought when she had that fall as well, to be able to come back from that fall and that nasty cut and still, whilst on the brink of victory, not panic, not lose momentum, just finish it well. I mean, that is another level altogether.
Now, Emma Raducanu learned to play at the Park Langley Club. Just have a listen to the moment the crowd there watched her win. Oh, that crowd there having a
sounds like the football.
They're having a good night. They're going to continue to have a good night.
How fun is that, though, that people got behind her so much that the match was able to go on free to air? I think made a huge difference in how many people have watched it. I think that was a great decision by Amazon, and that they've put the money back into British women's tennis especially. And there's just going to be so much growth in the women's game right now. I think both of these two tonight have been absolute superstars throughout the tournament. They are an absolute gift to tennis, and the way that they both played tonight is phenomenal. It was so fun to watch. It was so fun to commentate on, even though my heart rate was absolutely through the roof by the end of the match. And, you know, sky's the limit for both of them. But I just love how much the British public has got behind Emma Raducanu, and surely Sports Personality of the Year.
Social media has erupted, predictably. Simona Halep from World Number One, extraordinary. Emma Raducanu, Madison Keys and the WTA player, wow, and finalist at the US Open. Congratulations, Jack Grealish. Absolutely unbelievable, an inspiration to everyone. Jordan Henderson, lots of hand clap emojis, and then incredible, and then the trophy. Andy Roddick, who we saw watching on. These two young women are just, as you said, Laura, a gift to tennis, an absolute gift. The Duke and Duchess of Cambridge. Huge congratulations, Emma Raducanu, on your stunning performances and historic Grand Slam victory. Incredible. We're also proud of you. Leylah Fernandez, well done on your amazing achievements at this year's US Open. It has been a pleasure to watch. Gary Lineker, first time in my life, now this was a while ago, I've ever tweeted whilst on air. But my goodness, what a performance, what a triumph, what an amazing young woman. Congratulations, Emma Raducanu, on a truly staggering achievement. US Open winner at 18 without losing a set. Extraordinarily fabulous. And Jimmy Carr, Emma Raducanu, Jimmy Carr the comedian, 20 straight sets. What a performance, what a legend. The game I love was played so beautifully. I think it's okay if I shed a tear. Congratulations, Emma, and also well done on those A-levels. Remembering, Russell, that during all this, she passed a driving test and she got an A-star in economics and she got an A in maths.
Yeah, and she didn't even look at the results, did she, until after she had won her match in Landisville, Pennsylvania. What self-discipline and self-control is that, not to have a little look at the email before she went out to play her match? Yeah, I think you can say it's been quite a summer for Emma Raducanu. And can we give her permission now to lose in the first round of the Australian Open and nobody's going to get upset about it? Because I think it's going to be very, very difficult to go out there now and continue playing in this vein. We almost need to consider her again a player who is 18 and at the very infancy of her professional career. I know that's going to be impossible because she's going to play in prestigious tournaments, but I think clearly she and Leylah Fernandez now need a little bit of space, and the expectations for how they perform next season should not be as high as the way they performed here. But what else can we say? I'm as speechless as Andy Roddick, Jordan Henderson, Jack Grealish, Tyrrell Hatton, Madison Keys and Simona Halep, who obviously were struggling to come up with words as well.
Wait, it's tough, isn't it? We're all on radio and we're all actually sort of speechless. It's I've never known so many of us being in a position when you almost run out of things to say. So hopefully, adding some chat to this conversation, unless she's run out of words, is Naomi Brody.
Hello.
Welcome back. Hello.
I haven't run out of words.
Yay.
I'm so excited.
How
Gigi
are you?
Has to drink a blue WKD.
That's definitely not the first thing we'll talk about, or maybe it will not be the last. How's the blood pressure? How are you? How were you through the match? How did you see that contest?
Oh my goodness. I'm so glad it wasn't an anticlimactic final. I am just so happy they both produced the level of tennis that they have been producing for the past 2 or 3 weeks. And what a speech from Leylah Fernandez at the end there. Just so eloquent. And what else did you ask me?
I think that was about it, actually. But something else, because we've got a little WhatsApp group that's going with all of us, sort of commentators, producers, etc. And a picture was posted of Luke Shaw watching at the poker table, waiting, I believe, for Wes Brown. And you put under that, amazing how this has become such a crossover match.
Yes, I love it. How many people are getting involved in tennis, tweeting about tennis, have just watched the tennis, who, had it not been Emma Raducanu, most of the people in Britain wouldn't potentially be watching this US Open final. My favourite part is all the Brits who only really ever watch Wimbledon getting so mortified at the etiquette of the fans in New York and realising that Wimbledon isn't the only way that tournaments are played around the world, finding that part of it all hilarious. Can't believe how many fans are in the stadium. It's just like opened so many people's eyes to this sport. And what a great day, what a great week for tennis in this country, let alone around the rest of the world, but just in this country. I think it's going to have so many people wanting to go and play tennis over the next few weeks. And I just hope that it's dealt with in a different way than when Andy, because I don't think participation particularly went up in this country after he won US Open. So I just hope Emma's the golden ticket to get all these young kids involved. And hopefully she will be, because she's so, so young. I think she's so relatable.
Yeah, I think that's the big thing. She's really relatable. But I don't know if this is a question we'll ever get an answer to, Naomi, but how's she done it? How's she gone from 150 in the world at the start of qualifying to win 10 matches, 20 straight sets, and as the British number one, the world number 23, playing in her fourth senior level tournament? How has she done it?
Because she's simply played the best tennis, and she just has unwavering self-belief. There's, you know, again, the moments that you expect her to crumble under pressure, she actually said in her on-court interview afterwards, she was worried when her knee started bleeding that she was just praying she wouldn't hit a double fault. But of course, she absolutely didn't. She, again, just thinks about the process, thinks about what she has to do. Who serves out their first Grand Slam with an ace? Who does that? Emma Raducanu does that. It's just completely unwavering, her self-belief. And I am going to be so interested as to how long she'll be able to keep that going in her career, whether it's just a personality trait or whether it is something that's amplified by her age and by that fearlessness that comes with being so young. Because, yeah, so many of the women on tour can produce that level of tennis but struggle in the big moments. And that's what these two young players, both of them in the final, have done throughout this fortnight/3 weeks, if you're Emma.
And thinking ahead over the next couple of months, I'm sort of torn with what sort of schedule Emma should play. You know, should she take time off now, or should she just run with it and enter Indian Wells? I'm not even sure if she's on the entry list. She was actually on the entry list of a 60K challenger, which she was meant to play in the second week of the US Open. Her flights were booked after qualifying, and here we are 2 weeks later. But, you know, it's going to be really interesting to see, I think, how they plan that and what route she wants to go as well, whether she wants to take advantage of this huge confidence she's got at the moment.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be really interesting. We said before the match, didn't we, how well it seems that her team around her have done her schedule and stuff. We said, you know, she nipped straight to the States after Wimbledon. She got stuck in. She dropped down to ITFs when she needed the matches. She took wildcards to get into some higher level opportunities. So it definitely seems that she's getting good advice from somewhere. I would certainly imagine that she would play Indian Wells. Even if she hasn't entered, she's surely getting a wildcard.
I think she's a shoo-in for a wildcard.
She's in a pretty good position for one. So you'd have thought she'd be playing US Indian Wells at the very least.
Yeah, I would say so. But I think what would be sensible, and management aren't always that sensible, but they've got to realize that they've got plenty of time to make money for her and make money for themselves. And this is often the case. Sort of back in my day, you had to bounce all over the world to play exhibitions and matches. There wasn't a sort of as regular schedule, but she's gonna make millions, hundreds of millions. So don't put pressure on her to go out here and do all these photo shoots and do all these other things. I mean, sure, have a bit of fun doing it. Yeah, go
she's
on.
She's already done Vogue.
Go, yeah, okay. Well, there you go. But to go on, you
well,
know,
she's just got a decent check there. I don't think.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. So
I
she
think
doesn't
they're
have
just
to.
Just fine right now.
Yeah, I mean, go and do the. I was going to say David Letterman, not David Letterman anymore, but you know what I mean. The chat show. She'll be on that on Monday and have some fun, enjoy that sort of stuff. But you know, there's no need for her to put a lot of pressure on it. Take her time. And just enjoy her tennis in her moment. And she's only got another month, and then she's got an off season, so she can go and play Indian Wells, maybe another tournament, and then she has a good time to really decompose. And she's going to need that.
Serena Williams conceded 32 games on her way to the 2014 U.S. Open title. Emma Raducanu, the qualifier, the teenager, conceded 34 games on her way.
Absurd.
As Pat Cash just shakes his head. And Mark Steele has...
I saw neck from shaking my head so often. I just can't believe it.
Mark Steele's tweeted, Murray did it properly. He put us through 4 years of agony before he finally won. None of this straight from A-levels in Bromley to champion in 6 months nonsense. Naomi, you touched, when you came on, you mentioned Leylah Fernandez, and it was a really classy speech from her, but she's been like this through the tournament. I mean, the fight, the battling qualities, the everything of Leylah Fernandez to do what she did to get to the US Open final.
I mean, the run that Leylah Fernandez has had, you know, people were saying, you know, does she have the edge going into the final because of the ranking scalps that she had getting there? She had by far one of the toughest quarters at the start of the draw and somehow managed to come through it and then just kept going. She beats Svitolina, Kerber, Osaka. It's just been an incredible run to the final. Again, the speech was just beautiful. It was lovely comments that she made towards it being September the 11th and, you know, the attacks and the New Yorkers and how strong they are and stuff. She just seems to have that amazing connection with New York, doesn't she? And it didn't surprise me that they seem to be in favour of Leylah tonight with the support slightly. That obviously was still an incredible amount of support for Emma as well, but she's just been a crowd favourite. I think from that Osaka match when she came all the way back, was she 5-2 down in that match?
Yep.
And then since that moment, they've just loved her. And it's because of that fighting spirit. And she's just constantly smiling out there on the court as well. It just looks like she's absolutely loving every moment.
And Pat, on the flip side of what Raducanu is dealing with and scheduling for her, yes, there's so much for Fernandez to be proud of, but she said, look, this is going to be really tough for me to digest. So as a coach, would you recommend time away or would you recommend to immediately get back to it?
I think she needs a break. I mean, that's we just said that draw she's had has been, has taken a lot of sting out of her. She played well today, so I don't think it really affected the match. But you know, she needs to take a bit of time off. But since she's in decent form, I said there's only 4 weeks, 4 tournaments left. There's a couple in Europe, one in Korea, I think, but the big one is Indian Wells. So you know, take a couple of weeks off, get some practice, play Indian Wells, enjoy her time there. And then have off season. So the women have a longer off season, which is I think is very sensible. The men keep playing, and then they go off and play exhibitions and everything else where they can sort of cash in a lot. But there might be a moment where somewhere in November there's an exhibition match where the girls can play again and make millions of dollars somewhere. I'm not sure if that's.
Do they get a wild card into the WTA finals now? Or does Emma for winning the slam?
Is the WTA finals on?
They're planning on hosting it somewhere. It won't be in China where it's supposed to be, but they're
Guadalajara, Laura, I think.
Okay. I don't think they do wild cards.
Do Grand Slam winners get in automatically or not?
No.
No, but that happens in the doubles, doesn't it? But not in either the singles on the ATP or WTA.
I think they
tour.
Might change that rule like the men did.
Well at Indian Wells, though, assuming she plays, well, she's got to be up there. I'm trying to figure it out now on the race, but there's too many points. Too many points to try and work out.
I think you're right, Laura. if she were to follow up winning the US Open by going to the Californian desert in 4 weeks' time, 3 weeks' time, and winning Indian Wells, one of the most prestigious events on the tour, she probably would be in the top eight players of the year, despite having only played about 9 or 10 events, and qualify for the year-end finals. But, I mean, even by Emma Raducanu's standards, that would be some script to write.
Yeah, I think she just needs to deal with this one. Are you still working out numbers, then, or what are you doing?
Just... with the list in front of me, I think we can assume that Barty's not going to play it because she's probably going back to Australia and doing the 2 week quarantine, so won't come back out. And then Osaka, who knows what's going on there. So yeah, I'm getting excited.
You are getting excited. I'm going to leave you to work out who's going to be in the tour finals. Naomi, it's been a pleasure. I'm slightly worried I might be seeing you tomorrow with what's going on now. Emma's won, but
WKD, I heard.
It's been
WKD all round.
Yes,
been proper celebrations.
It's been a pleasure, Naomi. Enjoy your celebrations this evening. Now from 12 to 1 this evening. Oh dear, we've got.
Can
Kermode.
I get one of these things? I don't know.
You can
I
have
still
my,
don't
Pat,
know what you're talking about.
Pat, you can have mine. There we go. We've got Kermode and May between 12 and one at 1 o'clock. Hayley Hassel is here with Up All Night. Hayley, we don't have to talk about the blue drinks. We should talk about the tennis. I don't know if you were a tennis fan. You are now a tennis fan, but wow, what an evening.
I know. How, guys? Wow, you must be absolutely buzzing, as are we.